Okay. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the March 5th Town Council meeting. Would you all please rise for a salute to the flag? John, you want to lead us?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And if you'd all please stay standing for a moment of silence for our troops serving us at home and abroad. Thank you. Okay, thank you. Please be seated. Okay, in public comment tonight, before we get started with our agenda, we had a late addition, and Mr. Falvey, I see you in the audience. Would you like to speak?
My name is Jack Falvey. I live at 22 Cortland Street in Londonderry. As you know, I've been following the progress of our town's first attempt to utilize our planned unit development ordinance to rezone the Woodmore Orchards for mixed development. Everyone is doing their best to find a way in this uncharted legal ground. And no doubt mistakes will be made, and we all should be prepared to make whatever corrections might be necessary to get us back on track. In attempting to evaluate the developer's application for planned unit development under our new ordinance, it was determined that an unbiased third-party reviewer be hired to advise the town on the completeness and the merits and demerits of the application. I understand that some respondents to the RFP were disqualified because of a bias of having dealt with a developer previously, and therefore may have had a relationship that might preclude an objective evaluation. That seemed to be a reasonable disqualifier. Unfortunately, the Woodmont developer requested a non-public meeting with the town's third-party review consultant for the purpose of developing a relationship. It was reported that this meeting took place last week and thus added a non-transparent relationship bias between the developer and our previously qualified consultant. That being the case, I believe an inadvertent error was made that disqualifies our consultant, and their contract should be canceled and the RFP should be rebid. The consequences of this process affects every citizen of our town, as it will radically change the economic model of our town and the invested value of all the landowners who bought their property under existing zoning regulations. The impression of closed-door deals must be eliminated by every possible means. The fact that no town elected or appointed body met in non-public session satisfies the RSA, but does not satisfy the concerns of our citizens who want to know what is going on behind closed doors. This must be an open and transparent process if it is to work in Londonderry. I would like to respectfully request the town council to cancel the existing contract and direct the town staff to rebid the RFP. Thank you.
Okay.
Jack, before you go, I have a question.
Sure.
So your concern is that the meeting that was held with the third party reviewer and the developer and town staff wasn't open to the public.
Right.
Okay. Since this is, you know, since they're dealing with technical issues, do you expect the third-party reviewer to be under constant television coverage for his entire work on the project?
No, I was chairman of the Housing Redevelopment Authority and worked as a commissioner for 25 years with developers.
Mm-hmm.
We had no television.
Okay.
We had no closed meetings, no non-public meetings ever. They were not either requested, nor did we ever have them in 25 years. So the purpose of a closed meeting, I have to question, particularly on an item this sensitive to the town and to all of the town residents.
Well, but again, as you said, you were chairman of, I guess, the Housing Authority. That's an appointed position, so you were required to have a public meeting.
Correct, okay. But there were no private meetings on the side at any time, either with individuals or with any of our developers, and the developers did not meet with town staff.
But isn't it true, Jack, that if an applicant, forgetting Woodmont, but any applicant submits a plan before the planning board, even to, you know, subdivide a house to duplexes, the engineer or the lawyer who's representing the applicant and town staff are going to meet and probably discuss things. And that's not in public, and there's no objections to that. So I guess my concern is that I understand this is a big project, but the idea that we're now going to disqualify what the planning board considered was the best of the third-party reviewers over something that frankly happens every day, I'm just not getting it.
Okay, well, I guess that this is an exceptional case because we've never hired a third-party reviewer before in this nature because of the magnitude and the complexity of the problem or of the project. The town residents are very, very concerned about the openness and the transparency of this particular process. There have been comments about previous town councils and about the passage of the ordinance. And this has clouded the situation somewhat. And as we go forward, I think it would be best that we set some new precedents and some new procedures, being that if the press requests being present at a meeting such as this, they should not be barred, nor should members of the public be barred, particularly if the meeting is advertised, which it was, so everybody knew it was taking place. So to close that meeting gives the appearances of something going on that the town citizens are not allowed to see. So I understand the precedents before we got into the plan unit development, but the plan unit development is now a whole different case. So we have to address this, particularly because of the size and because of a third-party consultant, one of the qualifications of which was being unbiased. So all of a sudden, if there's going to be a meeting in which these people are going to develop some kind of a relationship, the question is, what kind of a relationship, and does that bias a third-party counsel?
Well, Jack, I mean, with all due respect, most of the time, I mean, I look at the third-party reviewer as our expert, as the planning board's expert, and essentially the town's expert in this thing.
Right.
Okay. The planning board of citizens, you know, 13 or 14 people that volunteer, they work full-time, they or do something else in town. They're not there during staff meetings and things like that. You know, I'm not even aware. I don't think anybody's an engineer currently on the planning board now. I may be wrong, but so we have to rely on an expert, okay? That expert, like every time in the past, meets, you know, the developer submits the plan, and the staff responds. I think what you're asking, despite the importance of the Woodmont project, is just something that can't be complied with. In order to give you full confidence, we'd have to have minutes of telephone conversations, records of emails, records of faxes. I mean, that's the only thing that's going to satisfy that. But Jack, you're saying, you know, there's a meeting. How do we know that they're not communicating by telephone?
Well, they can communicate outside normal channels, I am sure. I mean, that's not the purpose. When the meeting is declared to be non-public, all right, that declaration is what raises concerns in the town, a non-public meeting advertised. So if there are communications, and also I have to question the wisdom of taking our third-party consultant and using them to do other than evaluate the application as it's coming in. Why should they develop a relationship with the applicant? If you consider that the reason that we look for a third party without bias is so that the applicant could not influence the third party judgment, and then we give them an opportunity to do so, or at least make the appearances of such. So the appearance of impropriety or of a relationship building that would destroy the credibility of the third-party consultant is what I'm alarmed about and what I think we ought to address. We've never done it this way before. This is a totally unusual situation, and if we're going to go through this plan unit development process, we really should look long and hard about how we do it, and to allow non-public meetings with town staff advertised ahead of time, forbid the press to be there if they show up, or town citizens, and some were excluded. In that case, I think we really should question this process.
Can I ask Dave a question? Did we advertise this meeting?
Well, it was not posted as a public meeting because it was not a public meeting. A public meeting under the law.
Did we advertise it in the paper or anything like that?
Someone called the planning office in which they were, and they asked the question when we were meeting to start the process for review, and they were told the time and the place.
So we did not advertise it in the official way that we normally advertise a meeting?
It was not posted as a public meeting because it's a staff meeting, and it's not a posted meeting under state law.
Okay. For planning board activities, do we always use a third party as our engineer?
We do.
So we're using a different third party this time, but we always use a third party.
That's correct. And we always have staff meetings between staff, our third party consultant, and the applicant's engineer all the time.
Is our attorney always present for every meeting that we have like this?
Well, in this particular case, he is.
Yes.
All right, and that's at the direction of the town council?
That's correct.
Okay, so for the other meetings we have that people don't normally know about because they're like, if I had a meeting in my office,
mm-hmm.
we have our party there, yet we only in this particular case, because of some of the things Mr. Falvey has said and the sensitivity of the project, we have our town attorney in the room.
That's correct.
Okay, just want to make sure I understood everything.
That's correct.
Okay, just getting my facts straight.
Okay.
So,
thank you.
Perhaps you can, help me out here. What would you propose that we do going forward between staff and the third party reviewer and the applicant? I mean, do they every time are they supposed to have somebody there taking minutes?
I think that we should not legally declare a non-public session, and we should not bar the press from attendance if they show up, and we should not bar citizens from sitting in on the town's business. Would you agree that that would be reasonable?
Well, I agree that meetings where decisions are made, yes. I don't think we have to allow members of the public to walk into the town manager's offices and sit there during the day. I think. Well, but that's what you're asking, Jack. You see, you're asking that a staff meeting with the applicant be somehow subject to a public meeting law.
Well,
while technically it's not, that's what you want it to be.
I think what we have to do is you have to be sensitive to the feelings of the people of the town that deals are being made behind closed doors. It was the closing of the doors that was objectionable. And this was not a meeting in the town manager's office. This was 15 or 20 people, as I understand it, as it was reported. And for the purpose of getting the parties, the third party evaluator, familiar with the people involved in the applicant. Well, the third party's purpose is to evaluate the application, not to build a relationship with the developer.
Well, there's building, I just came off a trial in Springfield. I had a relationship with the district attorney. The defendant was convicted. The district attorney's going to send the client to jail. You know, I don't have a relationship with, but I have a working relationship. I can call her up and say, I need a police report. I think when you use the word relationship, you're using it in a way that it's not intended here. The relationship, I imagine, was, hey, these are our contact numbers. This is what we want, and staff is probably saying, this is the format we want this thing in coming to us for our review. Am I far off the mark?
Yeah, if I can just clarify, is that the only difference between this process and the other processes we go through every day in this building, working with third-party consultants and developers, is the size of this project. The reason the meeting was in this room as opposed to upstairs in the conference room is simply the size and the number of people who are there. Usually, third-party review has one or two people working with us. They had six, all different disciplines.
I have no objection to you having a meeting. I think closing the meeting to the public is my objection. And that then creates the idea that something's going on that we shouldn't know about. Why else would you close the meeting?
So Jack, if I may. So when staff is negotiating with the police or with the fire department or with any of those local officials that work for us, do you suggest that the public should be allowed to go into those meetings too? I mean, that's what you're opening the door to. There's no difference. What you're asking for, there's no difference.
I think what you have to consider is you have to consider the appearances of impropriety.
I know that I've sat as a counselor now since 3 years ago, and I know that there's been a lot of assumptions and a lot of accusations, and I think they're all completely unfounded and ridiculous. And I've seen, you know, my name thrown around out there, and I can tell you, nothing to it. It's all a bunch of hogwash.
It's nice that you assure us, but I think that you, as a public official and as a public body, you have to be sensitive to the feelings.
I'm very sensitive to the feelings, but I think no matter what we say, it's not going to be what you want.
It's not a question. It's not a question of what you say, it's what you do. So barring the public legally saying you may not attend the meeting, that's where the problem is, because then that gives the impression that something's going on that we don't know about, and that's what causes the innuation, the insinuations, and the feelings that there are deals being made behind closed doors. And if you want to alleviate that, make this process transparent, you will not make these non-public meetings legally.
But they're in a, in their very nature, they're non-public to begin with. Public isn't invited to this review between the, am I right, the staff meets with the applicant.
That's correct.
Because it was reported in the newspaper and a newspaper person showed up, that's the only reason there was any public involvement. These things are not handled that way. And now what you're requiring is, and with all the respect to the enormity of this project, okay, you can't treat him differently than you treat everybody else, okay? Because, you know, the fact of the matter is, Jack, you want to treat him differently than everybody else. Guess who's going to go to court and guess who's going to win?
I think the problem comes that when we declare a meeting non-public, we set a bad precedent. And I don't recall other meetings being declared non-public at the request of an applicant's attorney. In my experience in working with developers in the town.
Right. Was that ever declared non-public, Dave?
Did someone declare the meeting non-public?
Not that I'm aware of.
Yeah, so I don't know where
you're getting. It was never a public meeting to begin with.
Right. So in order for it to be declared, like when we have a non-public, we have to have a non-public under 91A. We have to verbally vote and what reason we're going out for. Mm-hmm. Now, the planning board can have a non-public for two reasons, okay? One is they can go out to meet with their attorney. Actually, it's one reason.
Yeah.
One reason. Yeah. They can go out and they can meet with their attorney. We can have one for two reasons. We can either go out to talk about employment issues or to meet with our attorney. Mm-hmm. Really, for no other reason can we have a non-public. One of the things we brought up here about 3 months ago was, is because of our concern about this project as a council, mm-hmm. we hired our town attorney to attend every meeting, every phone call, every conference call, be included on every email for the protection of the citizens of the town of Londonderry. I think we're doing the right thing by having legal counsel in the room. Because if legal counsel is in the room, I at least interpret that as everything that happens has to be above board, has to happen by the law, and there can't be any of this misconceptions of that something's going on, because our attorney is in the room representing our town and the people who live here. At least that was my intent in asking for it. So if they're having a meeting and our attorney's there, I'm pretty confident that they're doing the right things. Our town manager has been told by his employers, the town council, we have one employee, you will attend every meeting, every phone call, every email. It's your responsibility, and then your responsibility is to report back to us what's going on. Mm-hmm. And he'll come in here in his town manager report and say, here's what's going on, guys. It's all public. Mm-hmm. That's my understanding of what's happening. So I'm struggling with, like, we asked this in the last meeting. What else do we do? Are we missing anything?
Yeah,
I don't think we are.
I would say excluding the public from a meeting between the developer and our third-party consultant raises all, I mean, this is not my concern. This is a concern of a number of people, including me. raises the concern that something is going on. There could be a quid pro quo in there that we don't know about, even if the town attorney is in place and is watching what is going on for us. But I just think that the impression that's being given is not a good impression. What you do about it is the province of you people who are elected by the town. This is a very sensitive issue, and we have to have different rules or different ways of approaching it and be super cautious not to give the wrong impression.
Well, what our attorney has told us is we can't have different rules and we can't have different laws. We have to follow the letter of the law. We have to treat every applicant exactly the same. Because when we do have different rules and different laws and treat people differently, that's when we get ourselves in trouble. That's what he tells us. Now, I'm not an attorney. Tom's an attorney, but he's not that kind of attorney. But that's what they tell us.
Yes.
Now, if they're telling us something that's wrong, and they've been wrong before, okay, then I want to know.
I don't think there's any question, John, about the law. I think it's a question of what the impression is given to the citizens of the town. The citizens of the town want this process to be open. And when we close a meeting at the request of an applicant's attorney, there has to be a reason for that.
I'm told that didn't happen.
If to follow your thought to the logical conclusion, if our third-party consultant had reservations about the application itself and wanted to meet with staff, that meeting would have to be public, correct?
I have no idea.
Well, if you're making the point, Jack, that if there's a third-party consultant and a staff and the applicant in the room, and that's going to be a public meeting pursuant to your testimony this evening, if you remove the applicant, then I'm presuming it still has to be a public meeting. So if our third-party reviewer has concerns about the application, then what would preclude the applicant from being a member of the public sitting in that room listening to it?
I'm not talking about a hypothetical. I'm talking about last Thursday.
Well, I'm talking about a very real possibility.
That's a hypothetical. Last Thursday is a fact. We barred the press and we barred the public from a meeting concerning the Woodmont developer and our third-party consultant. And I question that because it raises concerns amongst the citizens. Now, what you do about it, how you make it more transparent, is a problem that we're going to have to deal with. My recommendation is that I think that the third-party consultant has now become biased because of that meeting, and I think that was an error. And that's just an opinion. You have to make that judgment. If you think that's not correct, if we shouldn't correct the error, that's fine. But I think you have to consider that that is the impression that was given to many of the citizens of the town.
But regardless of the impression, what factual basis do you have that the third-party reviewer is now biased?
What factual?
Because from what I understand is the public was excluded from the meeting, from what you're saying.
Yeah.
There's no reporter there. So you don't know what went on there, if anything went on there, other than perhaps exchanging emails and phone contacts and all that.
Yeah.
But you've now said that they're now biased. Okay. So I'd like to know what basis you have that on, what factual basis.
Because we don't have a factual basis to say that it's not. In other words, we don't know. You don't know. You were not at the meeting.
No.
I don't know. I was not at the meeting.
No.
So therefore, what we've done is we've created this business of something may have happened or may not, which is the impression. And the impression is what the problem is.
But we have our town staff. We have our town attorney. We have all the people there that we felt would be able to give us that opinion.
Then why close the meeting?
Because we wouldn't open it to any other developer either. I mean, it's just because it's Woodmont doesn't mean that we should open this up to the public. It's not what we do normally. It would put us in a very vicarious position legally.
We're treating him differently than anybody else. He's an applicant, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now he's, you know, under basically a cloud of suspicion under your scenario for whatever he does. If his attorney and his engineer meets with town staff, it's presumptive to be there's something going on there. I don't think that's fair, okay, number one. I don't think it's factual, and I don't think you're going to help the process, and frankly, your view of the process or your view of what the developer wants to do by basically, you know, having him work under a different set of rules than everybody else has to. And I think that's the easiest thing for him to walk in and say, they're treating me unfairly. because of what? Because some reporter was excluded from a meeting he had no right, or she had no right to be at.
I think that we should be in favor of transparency of the process. And that transparency is a major issue in this town right now. We have to be sensitive to that. How we're sensitive to that is a problem that we're going to have to deal with.
I agree with being transparent, but I also agree of being fair, and that you shouldn't accuse people of doing something.
I'm trying to hold my hand again, Jack. What's going on?
You shouldn't accuse groups of doing something unless you have some factual basis for it. So that's my problem, because because a reporter was asked to leave a meeting that they, I guess, weren't even, you know, there was at the discretion of whether they stayed or not. The idea that you then leap to the conclusion that something untold has gone on, they're biased, and now we have to terminate a contract, probably, and have to pay them, because under your scenario, I don't think there's cause for doing that. We're going to have to pay them the full amount of the contract price, and then go out and hire another third-party reviewer.
Andre, hold on a second, Jack. Andre, go ahead.
I guess if I could, part of my report tonight on the economic development was going to report on our meeting last week.
Nope, here's your opportunity.
Yeah, I think I'll just move that up to the front. Again, my name is Andre Guerin. I'm the community development director. Much of what I'm going to tell you today, I emailed to Jack. Jack sent me an email last week requesting clarification on the meeting that took place last Tuesday, and I told him it was a meeting at the request of the applicant to introduce our team to their team. And last Thursday at 2 p.m., that's exactly what took place. We asked our consultant, Howard Stein, Hudson, and Associates, to come down so they can meet the applicant's team, which we had two additional team members, which was Steve Cecil and Shook Kelly, which were the two additions to the team. Mike Kettenbeck, John Michaels, and Rick Chilman had been part of the original team, as well as Andre Duanis and a list of other folks. But Stephen Cecil and Shook Kelly were two new, even though Mr. Kelly was not there at the meeting. Just to introduce two parties, clarify what's going to take place in the beginning of this, which was simply taking their application and either making a determination that it is either acceptable or not. At their next planning board meeting, which will be March 7th, the planning board will have to set a new date. If the board remembers, back in the second meeting of February, as they established a timeline that if we received the escrow amount within, I believe, a week of that planning board meeting, it will hold to the March 7th meeting as the date to which the application acceptance will be determined. Given that the escrow was not received until several weeks later, and it was in between the times between the last planning board meeting and the March 7th, therefore the March 7th meeting will not be an application acceptance meeting, but it's going to be a recommendation for a new date to be established for the application acceptance. And so basically the meeting last Thursday, which just introduced one party to the other, exchanged cards, established what the protocol is going to be, and basically as all third-party reviewers are, as with our existing third-party reviewers, Stantec, everything goes through staff. If there's got to be a communication between town's third-party consultant and the applicants, and it goes through me, and then that is that connection is established at that point in time, not directly. Everything goes through the town, so we have a chain of command as well as a clear avenue for how communication will take place.
Seems pretty above board to me.
Meeting adjourned, and that was it.
Okay.
I wonder why the meeting had to be closed. If it's that innocuous, why was it closed? And the fact that it was is a fact, fait accompli. We can't change that. But the impression that was given was it was closed for some reason. We don't know what the reason was. So there could be an assumption, which is not a fair assumption, perhaps, that something went on, but we don't know factually that something didn't go on either. I appreciate very much the fact that Andre would report on this, and I don't question his report at all. I do question the problem we have with the appearance of impropriety or the appearance of non-transparency. And I think we just have to be sensitive to this because of the sensitivity of the entire issue.
You know, Jack, you have a remedy if you want to use it. I mean, there is an ethics resolution that was adopted by the town council. If you feel ethics were violated, then you should file that charge in accordance with it. There'll be there'll be an investigation and a hearing. For me personally, to vote on something that something happened based on not being there, not knowing what took place, and it not being outside the norm of what I've seen for the last 12 or 13 years, I can tell you, I've attended meetings in which the governor's there, you know, and we have a meeting with a developer. You know, I don't know what other remedy to send you down, because I wouldn't be able to say, let's get rid of the consultant based on what I know right now.
Mm-hmm. I appreciate very much the opportunity to present this point of view, but you have to be sensitive to how the citizens of the town feel about this process and about what's going on. And so I think we just have to be extra sensitive to these feelings because I hear them and I'm reporting back to you. So I reported these feelings and my feelings to the town council, and that's why I came here tonight, to make sure that this was up front and on the table so that perhaps this might allay some of the feelings that the town citizens have about the whole process.
But going forward, do you have a suggestion as to what we can do?
Sure, and that is, do not declare meetings non-public.
Okay.
Let the chips fall where they may.
So then people can just walk in. Are we going to now have to post the times that staff is going to meet with people?
I think that if a citizen asks the staff when there's going to be a meeting and there's going to be 12 or 14 people there, I don't think that should be closed to the public. And it's, if the public is sensitive to it or the press is sensitive to it and it's a large enough issue, why do you suppose the press comes to these things? Because it wants to poke into the town's business? No, because this is a major issue in the town. So if it's a major issue, I think the press has to be allowed to take a look at it. What's wrong with that?
Feel free. Actually, that would provide some guidance to staff, because I have several staff meetings with applicants in the upcoming days and upcoming weeks, and I'm just quite sure how I should govern that now.
Well, then what Mr. Falvey's asking for is that the only way to be fair to everybody is that we want to make a policy decision, draw up a resolution, and change the policy of how we do business in town, which would be a violation of the charter, in my opinion.
And it also...
We'd be interfering in the day-to-day operations of the town. I certainly would like to get our legal counsel's opinion on how to proceed with something like that, because, frankly, I don't know.
I also think that it would also be showing...
I just don't know.
It would also be showing... it would be probably a grounds for the applicant to also go to court on another unfair treatment. They've never done it before, and now they're going to do it because of me.
Yeah,
so I'm just saying what you're saying. I understand the sensitivity of it. I do get it. I live here, have for a long time.
Yep.
I think we're following the letter of the law, and I think that, you know, as per John, that was what he said earlier. We decided as a council a little while ago to make sure that our interests are protected by the attorney. Now, our attorney's 100% right all the time. Well, that can be argued. But the bottom line is we felt that in our best interest as a town, that because we didn't have anybody that was sitting on that board that's a legal person, they're all volunteers trying their best, that we would be better represented by having an attorney there. That way, everything's above board. Mm-hmm. And I don't question that. I really don't.
And Mr. Chairman and Jack, too, I wasn't trying to be facetious with that. Is this that we meet with developers and applicants a lot on various applications, whether it's a two-lot subdivision or a 300,000 square foot facility, which in the history of Londonderry, you know that happens. And therefore, that guidance would be appreciated.
Mr. Chairman, could I ask a question? Yeah. Andre, could you answer this question for me? If we had a developer, say, I don't know, Kohl's, and they wanted to take over, forget the fact that the ownership is connected here, but they wanted to take over the old Market Basket. And, you know, obviously, if a big company was interested in that, that property would be up and go up in value quite quickly if the people knew that they wanted to develop something like that and they were trying to negotiate. Isn't it important and safe for a developer to come into a private meeting with the town where they want to develop something of that magnitude in? Wouldn't there be some kind of a safety part on their end, a feeling of trust or a feeling of, you know, hey, I'm not going to stop publicizing this whole deal because it's going to cost me three times the amount of money as soon as people know I'm interested in going there. I mean, isn't there some idea of that going on with the people that want to develop in Londonderry as well?
Well, I think they're free to call staff to ask their opinion on with regard to whether it's development or building permits or whatever. They can feel free to come in or give me a call and ask my opinion or set up a meeting to discuss whatever their concept is. And my understanding of the law is that we're not obligated to submit something to the paper or advertise it or post it as a meeting because it's not a public meeting. It's a meeting that an individual has with staff to garner information.
But how unfair would that be for those businesses that want to come in that would expect that at least from us? Some, not secrecy, but some sort of, you know, ability to negotiate things in a proper manner with a town. That would put them, if we made it all public, it would put them in a really strange position.
Well, I think if that was a requirement, it will definitely change the way they would communicate with any community. If they know that if they're interested in building a new facility at a particular site, I'm sure that if we had a notification requirement for every one of those meetings, I'm sure that until they're absolutely sure, they're not gonna ask any questions or venture to do anything with that town until they're absolutely sure. So with that requirement in place, it would be hard-pressed for them to pick up the phone to talk with us. With the provision as the law is today, they can feel free to pick up the phone. Until they submit something officially to the community, then is this a conversation that they're having with any community in New Hampshire?
I think because we have an official application on the table, and that I tend to agree with you that we are following the letter of the law, but I think we have to be very, very careful that in following the letter of the law, we don't exclude the rights of the citizens to know what's going on in our town. We've got to find a mid-ground or a way of keeping the citizens informed so we do not create this impression, which has been created, that there are private deals going on. And that impression is where the problem is, not with the actual fact. The actual fact is that you are within, it seems to be, the letter of the law. But the impression certainly is not good.
So Jack, what you're saying is you wanted us to change or at least talk about changing the PUD, maybe to add in a line that states that all of these meetings in the future with development sizes of a PUD extremity, that we would have all of the meetings public for that particular item. Okay, so if we did do that, I want to let you know that if we did go and change that PUD, it would not have anything to do with Woodmont anyway.
I have no idea how you remedy this problem, but the problem definitely is real, and we should address it somehow. And so the problem is impressions and implications, and that's where the difficulty lies. So somehow we've got to get above the letter of the law and say, here's how we keep transparency in this process as best possible.
But you know, going from what you just said and what you said previously, where you don't have any basis, factual basis, for saying that somebody was making a deal after the reporter was excluded from the meeting. I mean, what's to prevent anybody, if they're inclined to make deals, you know, do you really think they're going to meet with staff and that's where the deal is going to be conducted? I mean, do you really think that's what's happening?
Well, we have no evidence to the contrary because the meeting was closed. So the issue is not whether a deal was made or not. It's whether we're open or transparent or not.
Well, but, you know, with all due respect, when you assume that if the meeting's closed, okay, there's a deal going on, you also have to factor in that the people there are not the decision makers. It's the planning board. They have their staff. They make a recommendation. So it would be different if the planning board was meeting because they're the ones who are going to vote and do things.
If the planning board were there, it would be illegal.
Right. It's staff meeting with the applicant.
But the third-party reviewer should not have a bias. And some of the respondents to the RFP were disqualified because of a supposed bias of having relationships.
And actually, there was an objection by the applicant to this third-party person, so.
Yeah, but I mean, that's a, sorry.
I just wanted to just clarify one thing. None of the applications, and now the applicants that submitted submitted a proposal for in response to RFP were disqualified. None. They rose and they made an objection to
the
applicant, VHAS, because of their attorney. But so, none of the applicants who submitted proposals
to there
RFP, there were none.
We have misinformation that you're presenting to us tonight. That's not true. You see what I mean?
Part of this is because we don't have transparency, Sean, and that's the difficulty. And if there's misinformation, it's because we're not communicating it to the people. And so the problem lies in one of transparency. We have to know the details. Otherwise, you're going to create the impression that we're missing details, which may not be factual.
Can I just address this one?
Okay, go ahead.
Mr. Chairman. With regard to the RFP and the selection of the consultant, just keep in mind that we clearly stated what we were going to be doing with regard to the RFP on December 14th. We clearly understood that we were going to be opening up those bids on January 4th. We clearly understood that we were going to make a selection of that list of our respondents to that RFP on the 11th. And between the 11th and the 19th, we were going to make a selection of the applicant. That was totally open to anybody who wanted to be there. Every aspect of this was under the auspice of the town, open to everybody who wanted to attend. Therefore, I guess I just respectfully disagree that that any of the selection process was done not in accordance with the right to know law or in accordance with the direction that the town council or the planning board wanted in.
I tend to agree, but we've now had one closed meeting, and the question is why?
Just
hold on 1 second. Dave's been waiting a while.
Yeah. Let me, first of all, I think your concern's sincere, and for that I will not dwell on the part of you accusing my staff of unethical behavior in a closed-door meeting, okay?
I didn't accuse them that. I said that
well,
there was a possibility
when,
of
when,
an assumption
you're asking,
being made.
When you're asked, well, you're an educated man, okay? And as educated man, you shouldn't be assuming presumptions of which nothing there. If there's no smoke, there's no fire. That's very simple. Here's the real world in economic development, as you should know, and as you and I discussed in my office 2 months ago for 2 hours, mm-hmm. Okay? This gentleman gets a lot of what I call tire kickers. Folks who come in and want to look at developing in Londonderry. Mm-hmm. If you want to stop economic development in Londonderry, make staff identify everybody wants to locate in Londonderry. They will go elsewhere. That's a fact. This is what really happens. It's not a secret. It's this simple. Developer comes in and says, I want to build a 20,000 square foot facility on lot 17-2. Well, that's nobody's real lot because they'll, anyway. and they say, what are the regulations? The staff meets the regulations. And they say, we have a problem with this regulation and that regulation. And we say, based on our experience, the planning board has either granted some waivers, no waivers, or all waivers in that particular regulation. I want to proceed with that waiver. It stops from our viewpoint. And it goes to the public forum with the planning board, because the planning board is the policy decision body who makes those decisions on waivers. It goes from staff to a public body, where that public body makes a decision in public according to the law. That's as juicy as it gets, Jack. Okay.
I can't disagree with that procedure,
If you want me to categorize what the meeting was last week, it was similar to a structuring conference before a trial, whereby both sides get together, they introduce each other, they understand the rules, the ground rules with respect to exchanging information, deadlines, recommendations we hope to make to the planning board for a new time frame, and then we go about our business until we meet next time before the planning board based upon the planning board's direction. It's that sexy.
I think there's a difference between apples and oranges here, and that is that the normal business of the town requires communication with developers, and I've communicated with developers in meetings myself for years. I understand that, and people can make inquiries. But once we have an application on the table for the PUD, I think all meetings should be transparent. We've never had a PUD before. Now we have it. So this would be a first time, only time, and therefore we should set a precedent for the applications to the PUD. And that's the request, that these things be transparent and open. Not that all meetings ever and every phone call be transcribed. That's not my request. My request is we have an application on the table. It's legal. It's open to the public. And therefore, all meetings discussing it should also be open to the public.
But doesn't that encompass a phone call between the applicant or the applicant's attorney and Andre? That's a meeting, Jack. You just said all meetings need to be open. That's a meeting. Two people are a meeting.
That's correct. And okay. Under the legal definition, two people are
well,
a meeting.
But, you know, if you know, I understand your view. Maybe it has to be a larger group. But what if some other person, you know, comes up and says, no, I want every communication between everybody transcribed.
I think that if the town council decides that there should be non-transparent dealings in the PUD, the town council is doing so at its own peril. The citizens have reported to the town council in detail that they have felt that this process is unwieldy and is not going in such a way that it is beneficial to the citizens of the town from the fact of being open. So all I'm requesting is that you open it as much as possible. And by reducing or eliminating non-public meetings, that would be a big step forward. How best to do that, I don't know.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Appreciate very much the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you, Andre.
Thank you, Jack.
Okay. We're going to go to our first public comment interview from Manchester Airport. Thank you. Okay. Pass that to me. Margot, for the record. And we have two candidates in the audience. I guess we'll start with Mr. Tamburello. You're over here. You want to step to the mic, please?
Sure. Dan Tamburello, 3 Royal Lane.
So this is for the Manchester Airport Authority representative to the town of Londonderry. Could you just basically give us a little insight as to your qualifications and why you want to step to this position?
Sure. Basically, I'll just stick to the my aviation part of my resume. I believe you all have full copies of my entire resume. I started out as a private pilot's license when I was in college at Liberty University, where I got a degree in government. Started out in a Cessna 152 and 172. And that's what I attained my private license in. After I graduated, I went on to the Marine Corps and the flight program. Applied and admitted to the flight program. Flew the T-34, the T-2, and the T-45. T-34, all three of those aircraft are the, that's the training and the training pipeline. All three of those aircraft are what are considered by the FAA high-performance aircraft, variable pitch propellers. More than, I think, the number, it might not be the exact number incorrect, but 400 horsepower. And two of them are turbine. One is a turboprop, the other two are turbojet. The T-45 is actually technically a turbofan, which is different than a turbojet for those who are airplane enthusiasts. I went on to advanced fighter training in Meridian, Mississippi, carrier qualified in the T-45. And went to Naval Air Station Oceana and learned to fly the F-18. All told, I have about 500 hours in various types and models of aircraft, 400 high performance and 300 in jets. Okay. And I have a master's degree in systems engineering from Johns Hopkins University.
Dave, this can you give a little background for the audience and for us as far as what the position is entailing? And
sure. The city charter of Manchester has created a Manchester Airport Authority, which is an advisory body only to the operations of the airport. They have provided for two seats for Londonderry residents, since about 70% of the airport is physically located in Londonderry. And so any recommendation the council makes goes to the mayor, board, and alderman, who is the appointing authority for the Londonderry positions on the airport authority. They are three-year terms, and an authority member can only serve two consecutive full terms, and then it has to be someone else has to be appointed to that position.
And that's one meeting a month?
I believe it's one meeting a month. John, you've...
It's more like one meeting a quarter.
A quarter? Okay. All right. So that's a little bit of the background of it. And obviously, having a pilot's license as part of the requirement of the position.
And I forgot to add at the end of that, my FAA rating is commercial multi-engine instrument land. And I haven't flown actually since 2002, but that's besides the point.
All right.
Going to questions?
Yeah.
Just a general question. Why do you want to be appointed to this board? What do you think you can do to help the town of Londonderry and the town of Manchester?
Well, for one, I I've previously testified on a different issue, I live on the extended runway of, I think it's runway 36. I'm not sure the exact number of the runway, but it's the one that goes north-south, which is a long high-range road. And I know we periodically have issues with aircraft transiting up and down high range road, because that's I think one of the primary final approaches into the Manchester Airport. I know the VOR or VORTAC is on the MAC property, and that is what they used for the approach into that runway for one of the instrument approaches. So I think I have a firsthand primary experience in both flying aircraft and in being on the ground and seeing any issues they might cause with noise abatement or approach procedures.
And where do you work, Dan?
I work for the MITRE Corporation, which is a federally funded research and development corporation in Bedford, Massachusetts.
So it wouldn't have any association with any airline operations?
No. In fact, I don't, but one of the divisions in my company, which is based, and MITRE has two basic headquarters. One is in Bedford, Mass, and one's in McLean. One of them actually works as the federal government's systems subject matter expert for the modernization of the FAA air traffic control system.
Thank you.
John?
Dan, thank you for stepping up. Appreciate that. What is your position? The Airport Authority, I've attended many meetings over the last couple of years. What is your position on the development of Pettingill Road? And the airport is actually an owner of one of the parcels that goes along Pettingill Road.
I have absolutely no position on that issue.
Then, with keeping that in mind, have you had any discussions with Mark Brewer, the airport director, about what would be required and what he's looking for with regards to people who are serving on the board and how he's shaping things?
I have not.
What's your position on development around the airport? Do you believe it's a good thing, a bad thing? Should we not do it? Should we follow the lead of the airport? They are the economic development engine of the area.
From a professional standpoint, I have no opinion. But from a personal standpoint, I like having that new access road over there, because mm-hmm. It actually adds 10 miles to my commute, but knocks 5 minutes off it. And I think I'd be able to knock off another minute or two if Pettingill were developed.
All very important things as far as I'm concerned when it comes to commuting and to people who want to move there. I don't have anything else. Thank you.
Thanks, Sean. I appreciate the new face. You know, it's always nice to have the new faces stepping up to do different positions, and that's really all I have. I appreciate you coming up today.
Okay. Thank you, Sean.
Thank you.
John.
Appreciate it, Dan. Thank you. Mr. Young, come on down.
My kids would say, here's the wicked old face.
Not always a bad thing.
Every day, I don't think it's a bad thing when I look in the mirror now.
Thank you for having me. Yeah, that was the scariest thing, running for school board this year when all the papers asked my age. I try not to think about that. My interest in the airfield and the airport actually was sparked in 1982 when I moved here to Londonderry. And when I did move here, they used to do air shows up at the field. There still were commercial flights then, and they would come in on the commercial flights, and they would just shut the air show down while the airplane landed. It was an interesting time then. That was back when it cost a dollar to park, and you could fly to Chicago for a pretty reasonable price, and they even had first class. And it was a great situation. And the parking has gone up. a little bit. As a matter of fact, that's the largest business sector for the airport is its parking, which is why it protects it so much around the field. In the 1990s, after traveling the world and coming home to take care of my family as a single dad, I always wondered what those numbers were on the end of the runway. And the one that we're referring to earlier is a big 3-5. It has to do with the direction that the runway goes in. So I went up to the airport and found a flight school and talked with them. The flight school is actually located in Londonderry, and it's still in operation, located in our town. If anybody's interested, it's a great place to go and go for a scenic flight, and they'll always let you take the controls. During the 1990s, I earned my single-engine land, my instrument rating right at the Manchester Airport, which it was called at the time. It was a great opportunity to work out of this Class C airspace, which is a busy airspace, and get to know the tower, get to know the procedures and the equipment and approaches to the field. At the end of the 90s, I left the field to earn my single-engine C, and I did that on the Merrimack River because we don't have any rivers or lakes here in Londonderry to learn it on. And I went on from there to be checked out in flying boats and enjoyed that quite a bit. The late 1990s, I actually applied for this position, and I was turned down. So I went to Dick Plant, who was the town manager at the time, and I said, Dick, I said, what happened? Why did I get turned down? And he just looked at me and said, but you don't know anyone. I said, gee, I don't know. I worked with LAFA. I worked with the Scouts and Cub Scouts and Boy Scouts and around town. I said, what do you mean I don't know anybody? And he said, well, none of you guys knew me. So, and it wasn't you guys at the time, it was a selectman. So I went down to town hall and decided to run for the budget committee. I was going to run for town council, but it cost a dollar, and I didn't have any money with me.
True conservative way.
So I ended up on the budget committee for 3 years, and that was a great time. And I learned a lot about the town, and also people got to know me better in the political side. So I asked again to be appointed to the Manchester Airport Authority, and they appointed me, and that was in about 2002. I served my terms, reaching the term limits for the what Manchester has put in place, and those terms, the limitation or the requirement, the waiting period has now expired, so I qualify for this position again. The opportunities that I had at the airfield to work on there, it is an advisory only position, and the interesting thing about that is because it's advisory only, you have to manage yourself in a little bit different way, because if you intend to be influential about what's good for Londonderry or what's good for the airfield, you need to make sure that you can get along with the staff and get along with the board, because they don't have to listen to you. I did move into leadership for the past 3 or 4 years that my tenure up there. I was the secretary, which is pretty unusual because of a 7-member board, we only have two of us. Manchester has a super majority there. There's a certain number of rules to be on the authority. They have to have a certain number of union members. They have to have a certain number of pilots. It isn't that everyone needs to be a pilot, and those limitations will whether being a union member or a pilot, and there's a couple more that I can't recall, will affect who can and cannot get appointed. While on the board, I served as the with the chairman. I served as the search committee for the new airport director, and we selected the present director. He actually flew home from trying to negotiate an international agreement for his other airport. From Ireland, and came in for the interview and then went back to continue negotiating, which impressed me. And he did it on his own dime. He paid for it himself. I've also run for the school board in 2003. As you all know, I've served 3 terms and I'm running again. I served on the 2004 Master Plan Steering Committee, the Historic Properties Task Force, the Public Safety Dispatch Service, if we ever get to it, so I'll talk faster. In 2010, after I left the Airport Authority, I was contacted by the Manchester Airport, and they asked that I would participate, and they assigned me to the Master Plan steering committee for the airport. And we completed that work after about a year's worth of work. The interesting thing about that plan is looking outside the fence, not inside the fence. It's looking to developing the area. It's looking to making sure the Pettingill Road goes through, that the airport has access to its property in that area, that the airport has access and growth in that area. They are hyper-interested in getting the 1,000 acres developed with businesses. The reason's pretty simple. They don't make money on people traveling to Florida for vacations. They make money on business travel. So what we need to do is we need to get positive, desirable commercial industrial development in up by the airfield so that people from places like Kluber and Stonyfield and Insight and Harvey Windows, when they go on to go travel, they go and they run down to the airport and they buy the most expensive ticket possible. That's what gets the airlines in there. And for those of us that might like to travel for fun, that means the prices will go down for us. But they need that business travel, and that's critically important. Another function that I did when I was there, while I was on the Manchester Airport Authority, nobody believed the airport access road would ever be done. Many of us didn't believe it would be done. So they contacted the airport authority members and said, call your contacts and we'd like to have them come out for a tour. So I ended up calling the president of Coca-Cola, the Kluber people, the Bosch people, the Insight people, the Stonyfield people, the high-level management, and saying, come out and let's go on a tour and let's see this road, because this road is going to be completed. And that was about 3 years before it was completed. That trip and the leverage from those executives was able to put some pressure on it and was able to finish that road 1 year early. Well, the bad news is we got a stub sitting there and we need to take a look and get Pettingill Road moving on it, but it was done a year early, so I guess we can be a little late on it. So that's kind of my experience as it relates to the airport. I cannot stress enough the desirable commercial and industrial development in that area in order to help the airfield. The master plan looked at that. They looked at the region as a whole and drawing passengers in from as far north as Portland and Burlington and south as from Boston. There's some thorns in the side of the airport that need to be worked on. We have a bus system that travels and takes everybody down to Logan, and it's paid for by the state of New Hampshire. It drives the airport nuts. And I think that I would do well on the board again because of my experience. This is one of those positions where experience counts, and I think it could help out. So thank you for considering.
Okay, thanks, Steve. Questions from the board?
Start with John this time.
I'm all set. I think he answered the questions I asked. So.
Okay.
I'll go with Tom.
No, I'm all set.
Just the same question. I think you already answered it, but why you really want to go jump back in? I mean, you feel that right now, from what you said, I can understand that right now you think that experience is going to do the board well. Can you give me another reason why you feel you're the right person for the job?
Last week, when a situation occurs where you talked about it earlier, you hear about development, you smell something coming, you see something going on. I pick up the phone and I call Mark Brewer and say, Mark, this is going on. Did you know about it? Are you interested? Can you help us with it? I've contacted Mark in the past when other businesses have been interested in the community and said, Mark, these people are interested. Can I bring them in and show them the world-class field that we run? Show them the tonnage of transportation that we push out of here in air freight every day. The amount of mail that ships out of this airport so that they know they're coming. You know, it's like being able to point to Granite Ridge Energy. You can say, here, we have the power in this region. We don't need to worry that we're going to run out of power. We can say, look at this airfield. We have this airfield, and that airfield can take care of your business, so you should be moving your business here. So I think the master plan looked at the outside of the fence. I know the inside of the fence, and the inside of the fence is a blast. I landed during the fire session where they do a training session every 3 years, one night in my little aircraft, and it was pretty impressive to come down in the middle of everybody trying to save everybody in the fake airplane. But the key now with the airfield is that development outside the fence, and to get some businesses in so that we can get some airlines in, bigger airlines, and more flights. out of this community. As far as the noise and those services, I certainly have a sensitivity to that. There's a format that the board goes through, and it does hear all of the people that complain about the noise that might come from aircraft. As a matter of fact, there was one meeting I remember. I'm looking at the chart, and there's one dot on the chart, and I said, boy, that's near my house. And I kept looking at the map, and I said, that's across the street from my house. And the people across the road from me complained about a military flight that had come in. But since they've changed the engines and gone to the quieter engines, that hasn't been as much of an issue. The airport rotates 65-35, so that not all of the flights, meaning 624, the other runway, gets 35% of the flights, and 3517, the north-south runway, gets 65%. So we don't get all the flights anymore. Bedford has to take their fair share. So standing up for Londonderry and making sure that that percentage stays there, I think is a task that I have being on the authority to make sure that they don't slip on that. Sometimes there's construction, they have to shut down one of the runways, and you have to take more than your fair share. But making sure they do that, making sure the noise abatement procedures are in place. They've completed the soundproofing of everyone's homes, so there's no one else that's going to be on that list. The town has signed an agreement that if someone builds homes in that area, they need to make sure that they're soundproofed or they're not responsible for it. There's a fellow up there with a log cabin that doesn't want to put triple track windows on his house, so I can understand, or air conditioning.
Thank you very much.
All right. Well, thanks again for stepping up,
sure.
Steve.
You're welcome.
Appreciate your participation. All right. So back to the council. That's what I'm going to get into.
Okay.
So we have a person that submitted late this afternoon to Margo. Councilor Dolan is not here, so it's council's purview as far as, you know, we have the four of us here. We can make a decision tonight with what we have, or we can accept this late entry into it and put this off to when Councilor Dolan gets back. It's council's purview. So you guys...
Well, in addition to that, I'd like to have a conversation with the airport director, and because I haven't spoken to him about this, and make sure, and he's got to make the recommendation to the alderman. So we probably should have at least have the courtesy of having a conversation with him. I think anybody who shows interest, we should talk to.
Okay, that's fine.
I agree with that.
Okay, so what we're going to do is we appreciate the applicants coming in tonight. We're going to have one more person that submitted late today. Margo will set it up in one of the council's next meetings in the near future. Hopefully I'll be around for that. And also when Councilor Dolan gets back from traveling. So we're going to put that off tonight. So before we go to Andre, how many of you, show of hands, how many of you people are here for the Kelly Road question on the road? Okay. So that you guys don't have to sit tonight, I wanted to let you know it's not a public hearing. Tonight is a first reading. So what the council will do is they're going to read it, decide whether or not to move it to a public hearing if we think it's worth it, but we won't be taking public comment on it tonight. The public comment will be saved for the next, if it gets that far. So we're going to have to hear from staff as to why we should be changing it, if it's valid, if it makes sense. It might not even get past that. I can't speak for the other councilors. So if you want to stay for that, you're more than welcome. I don't like kicking out people, because it's always nice to have everybody in the audience. But if you want to go home and you're not comfortable sitting in the seats right now, you can do so.
Mr. Chairman?
Yep.
Would you entertain maybe a show of hands of for or against, just so we have a kind of an opinion? Would that be out of the ordinary? Or?
I'd rather not. So I'm pretty sure that if they're in the audience, they're probably against. So that's my suggestion. Unless we wanted to move that up right now and put out economic development. Council purview.
Well, I mean, public safety is next, and then it's economic development according to the agenda.
Right. Yeah. I'm sorry. That's true.
I have no objection to at least reading the resolution, hearing from staff, so that the nice folks who have come down can at least hear the point of view of staff, so if they want to form an opinion for the next meeting, they have all the information they need.
That's fine. We can do that. So are you guys okay with...
I'm fine.
Moving up to that right now?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's do that. So if we could get staff for the road renaming, we'd like to take that out of order so that the residents here that have spent their time waiting can at least get some input onto this as to why we're going to be looking at this change.
Nobody likes I'm going to read it.
Yeah, could you read it, please? Thanks.
You want to do it, Jeff?
You can do it if you want.
Resolution 2012-02, a resolution relative to the renaming of Kelly Road. The first reading is being held on March 5th, 2012, this evening. Whereas the town of Londonderry is enabled by NHRSA 231:133 to name public highways, and whereas the town council established a street naming system task force to enhance public safety by reviewing and correcting addresses which are non-compliant with NH 911 addressing standards, and whereas Kelly Road, with an EY, and Kelly Avenue, no EY, just Y, have been identified as non-compliant, and whereas the task force in cooperation and consultation with property owners recommend the following alternate street names. Now therefore be resolved by the Londonderry Town Council that Kelly Road be renamed Horizon Road to become effective within 60 days of adoption of this resolution. Properties will be renumbered according to the town addressing policy. So, second.
Yep, I need a second. You got a second from Joe. Okay, so we have a motion and a second for discussion, and we'll bring it to staff to hear the reasons why.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. For the record, I'm John Vogel. I'm the GIS manager for the town, and this is Karen Marchant, the assessor for the town. We rise today to ask your support of Resolution 2012-02 regarding Kelly Road. This is a continuation of our work to remedy some of the confusingly similar street names in town. As the council is aware, we worked on a number of streets so far, Whispering Pines, Mobile Home Park. We've worked on Harvey Road. We worked on some of the east and west streets in town. We worked on Nelson and Sargent Road in town. As we move through our list, Kelly Road was next. We do have both the Kelly Road and Kelly Ave in Londonderry. Both of those streets were reported to us by 911 in a memo in which they identified the streets that were confusingly similar. So we went through a normal process to remedy that pair of streets. We heard some safety concerns from the airport regarding Kelly Ave, and we're asked to keep the name Kelly Ave in place. Their concerns was that the change would prove difficult to administer through some of the 80 or so agencies that would respond in the event of a crash at the airport. We treat that as a valid safety concern, and then thus we recommended to moving ahead with changing Kelly Road. Again, we went through the normal process. I think all of the members of the audience were at our public workshops. We asked for suggestions for names. And throughout that suggestion process, the name Horizon Road seemed to rise to the top. And we went ahead and are recommending the change to Horizon Road.
Okay, is that pretty much it?
That's it.
While you were there, what was the resident feedback as far as changing the road names?
The resident feedback was opposed. The residents believed that they were strongly in favor of keeping Kelly Road the way that it was. That it seemed to be their opinion that it was not a safety issue. Again, having been brought to us by 911, we felt an obligation to act. In our perspective, it is a safety issue.
One other question I had is in regards to this. What's the residential breakdown and business breakdown on Kelly Ave? I'm trying to find out the reason why we don't want to change Kelly Ave.
Kelly Ave is a business street. It runs parallel to the runway at the airport.
Yep.
We have three businesses located on that street.
Mm-hmm.
Again, the objection to changing Kelly Ave came from the airport. We invited the airport to be in attendance. I believe there's a member of the staff present who can speak to the airport concerns if you'd like more detail.
Would like to hear that.
Well, he did submit a letter to us as well.
Okay, do you want to read it for the record?
Dear Chairman O'Keefe and honorable members of the Town Council, Manchester Regional Airport has appreciated the opportunity to work closely with the Town of Londonderry as the Street Naming System Task Force continues its efforts to rename several roads located within the adjacent to the airport district. As the committee has been tasked to represent the best interests of the town, it is my responsibility as airport director to ensure the continued safe and efficient operation of the airport. I am writing today in support of the task force recommendation that Kelly Avenue, which runs parallel to the airport's main runway, is located in both the city of Manchester and the town of Londonderry, remain named Kelly Avenue. After thoughtful consideration and communication with various federal, state, and local agencies involved in the airport's emergency response coordination, I believe it is in the best interest of the airport that is a vital corridor bears the same name in both municipal jurisdictions. Kelly Avenue has multiple references in the airport's mass casualty plan, airport certification manual, airport security program, airport emergency plans. These important documents help guide emergency response for more than 80 regional agencies. The airport believes that having Kelly Avenue as one focal point might limit confusion and possible expedient response. As an example, the secure portal onto the airfield is located at one end of Kelly Avenue in Manchester, and the law enforcement and the other emergency responders staging is located at the other end of Kelly Avenue in Londonderry. The roadway name change at the city and town line may be confusing to the responders not familiar with the area. Mr. Chairman and honorable members of the council, I hope you will look favorably upon the task force recommendation that Kelly Avenue in Londonderry remain unchanged. Thank you. Sincerely, Mark Brewer, Airport Director.
Thank you, John. Okay, so now I'll bring it to the professionals. Guys, what's the logic in keeping one over the other, in your opinion?
The biggest thing that, at least with the fire department, I think the police department stands the same way. Obviously, one of them should be changed because of the similarities. There's obviously a possibility of a, you know, going to the wrong, you know, having the wrong response because of Kelly Road, Kelly Ave.
Mm-hmm.
Our staging area, the main gate for all responses to the airport is one Kelly Ave at the airport. As the letter stated, every surrounding agency that responds to an alert one, alert two, anything that we have at the airport, whether it be just a malfunction with a plane, a crash, goes to Kelly Ave. And that's something that it's just a, speaking with the airport, seems to be a tremendous overtaking of, you know, what it would take to change all those documents. My understanding is also in some federal documents, it's all listed as Kelly Ave. And so to change everyone else, you know, we understand it's an inconvenience for the residents. I don't know of any road that we've changed where the residents have jumped at the opportunity to change the street name. But we're looking at a safety factor. One of them has to change, which is the greater impact. It looks like would be Kelly Ave being, you know, with the response to the airport because the staging areas are in Kelly Ave and Manchester and London. And if we end up with changing ours, Manchester has no plans of changing theirs, then the staging areas right now it's Kelly Ave. So there might be some confusion with having two different staging areas within the two towns.
When you say staging area, do you mean one Kelly Ave Manchester or one Kelly Ave Londonderry?
I believe the police and some of the other staging areas is in Londonderry, part of Kelly Ave. The fire response is one Kelly Ave in Manchester, where the gate is, actually at the crash fire rescue.
So by changing the name, I was thinking that, you know, the address would be all in Manchester, so by changing the name in Londonderry, it wouldn't affect where your response would be. Is that correct?
No, because, correct me if I'm wrong, the police response staging area is on Kelly Ave in Londonderry.
And fire is different?
Correct.
Opposite okay. End of the road.
There's just not enough space to put everybody. When we go to an alert two, it's a large response.
Okay. All right, so there's the reasoning. Now we all have that to mull. What do we have for a breakdown on businesses and residences on Kelly Road?
Except for home-based businesses. There are some.
On Kelly Road.
It's a residential neighborhood.
And it's 12? Is that over?
About 12 or 14.
About a dozen, I think, isn't it?
Yeah,
It's the cul-de-sac right above Litchfield Road, right off of Litchfield Road.
Correct, it runs southerly off of Litchfield Road,
right.
Correct. Yeah, I believe the
I believe the count is, I thought it was closer to 15. We can check. But my understanding is that there are three home-based businesses on that street, people working out of their homes.
And how many did you say, Kelly Avenue? How many residents and business together?
Zero residents. And my understanding is three businesses.
Well, it looks like five locations. There's Tinkham Ave Properties, there's MHT Hangar 5, and there's three MHT Airport Authority buildings. It's going slow.
And then a lot of paperwork to redo as far as emergency services, which is the bigger one, it seems.
Okay, so.
Well, okay, so I guess those are the facts as we have them. So we can't do anything tonight.
Yeah, but we can ask Bob questions, right?
Okay, yeah, that's fine.
Hey, Bob, how are you?
Good, how are you, John?
All right, how's the new position being in, you know?
It's challenging, in a good way.
Have we had any problems with Kelly Ave and Kelly Road, to your knowledge?
In my 24 years serving the town, no.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other council questions?
Fire dispatch, same question?
Not to my knowledge, but like I said, I don't know of every call and everything that goes on in that place 24/7. So to my knowledge, no, but can't say that it hasn't happened.
So just to share something with you guys, I was in Manchester. Unfortunately, I was in Logan Airport taking a flight someplace and was going through Terminal C, and I gave my ID to the TSA agent. He goes, "Do you know anything about Kelly Road?" He says, "I live on that road."
So yeah, we're changing the name.
In the audience. Yeah.
So I would say there was some sensitivity to, you know, that, you know, the residents of Kelly Road, since the TSA agent asked me if I knew anything about it.
Did you say you wanted to change it and got frisked even more?
I said to him, "Nothing has come before us, sir."
Good answer.
Well, smart, yeah, answer.
Always tell the TSA agent the truth. So I would say that, you know, they're not here to speak tonight, but there is obviously, like every other name-changing piece we've dealt with, there is a fair amount of, you know, interest from them. Now, you know, what's been presented to us is that Horizon Road is acceptable. So I guess what I would advise them is that they, if they want their point of view heard, they should make sure they come back on the 26th and make sure that their point of view is heard.
Yeah.
Or we can say no and have them go back to the drawing board.
Well, we can. I mean, but, you know, like everything else that I think we try to do is I think
listen,
we try
to
gather
public,
all the information, and, you know, and then try to make a good decision based on the information that we gather.
Do we have, as we talked about earlier, do we have, in other sessions that we had, is there a significance for the Kelly Road? Does anybody know?
historical
significance?
Reed?
Don't know.
Kelly Road, historical? So there is some backing of that.
Okay. Do we have that letter available to us? Anybody know? No?
I mean, not here.
I've not seen it.
You guys have a copy of that? No?
We actually don't.
Okay. Maybe we can make sure we bring it on the 26th. It'll be important.
Does staff, do you guys have it? You don't have it?
Yeah, we don't have it here.
John, did you get it?
I don't remember. I remember Mrs. Beal. I think she attended some of the meetings, but I'll be honest, I don't remember the letter.
So if I could make a suggestion, maybe the person who sent the letter after we conclude this piece could come up and give Margo their information, Margo could share her information. They could send the letter to her so that we, you know, because Margo's in charge, remember?
Absolutely.
Margo has the shillelagh.
So
I know.
If we get it to Margo, then it will get to us.
Okay. So, go ahead.
Well, thanks, Sean. Just to add in, like I say, I think part of the reason that we're doing this, because you guys had asked if it had ever been an issue in the past. As a safety standpoint, I know it's my job, I'm sure Bob feels the same way. It's not our position to wait till it's an issue. We hadn't had major issues with Spring Road until we lost a house. I don't want to see someone, you know, in that same circumstances, you know, wait until something goes wrong. That's why we're doing this.
That's a good point. That's a good point.
You know, my job is prevention in the town, and that's what I'm trying to do is prevent an issue. Not sure which counselor it was, but one of the Hardy-Hovey Road meetings, one of you even said, It's not like Kelly Road and Kelly Ave.
Right.
You know.
Right.
It's, they're similar.
It was one of them. It wasn't me.
I think it was him.
There's 23 houses.
You know, what your decision is your decision. But we were given the task by 911 and the town council to see what the issues are. I mean, you can't say that Kelly Road and Kelly Ave aren't similar.
No, you can't.
Yeah. So
they're spelled differently.
Well, but when somebody calls on the phone, that's, you know, and they're having a medical issue, and all you're getting is Kelly.
I get it.
And, you know, we just want to try to prevent a problem instead of reacting to the problem later.
Brian, absolutely. All part of the information we need to gather and make a proper decision. Agree.
Yep. All right. Thanks, guys. Appreciate it. Thanks, Bob. Thanks, Brian. Okay, so, folks, that's it. Obviously, there is some concern there, and it does deserve to be heard. We also want to hear your input, too. So this is going to be on the 26th, March 26th, here at 7 o'clock. And please, obviously, come back here. That's when the public hearing will be, and everyone can have their input into it. And we'll go from there. Thanks again. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, now let's go back into order. Do we need a vote on that? Yeah, okay. All right, so all those in favor of moving ordinance resolution 2012-02 relative to the renaming of Kelly Road, signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed, chair votes affirmative. Motion passes 4-0 to move to a public hearing March 26th. Okay, and now we are going to have the Public Safety Dispatch Committee report. Sorry it took so long, and thanks for your patience. Thanks for coming out tonight, folks. Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I'm John Valiquette, the vice chair of the committee, the Londonderry Public Safety Dispatch Service Study Committee. A lot of our members are here tonight, and you charged us with the responsibility last August to put something together and do something for the town, and Chief Ed Nolan is going to give you a presentation of our final report. Recommendations to you.
Thank you, John.
Thank you, John. Thank you to the town council and to Dave, Karen, and Margo for their trust in our committee and inviting us here this evening. Please bear with me. Both my ears are blocked as a result of a sinus problem that's going around. So if you see me doing this in response to a question you're asking, just speak a little louder. The committee has an agenda to follow. In this agenda, we're going to talk about background, the composition of the committee, what the committee's mission and as designated by the town council is, what our plan of action to conduct our study was. We will also talk briefly about a review of previous studies and proposals, and a new study and analysis activities, known and potential growth impacts, what our committee consensus was in regards to duties number 5 and number 6, and then our committee assessment and recommendation to the town council. The background of the committee and the issue confronting the town council and the community of Londonderry. Currently, Londonderry operates and maintains independent communications and dispatch centers for both the Londonderry Police Department and the Londonderry Fire Department. Currently, the state provides services, 911 services, throughout New Hampshire. There have been two previous recent local studies to explore cost-effective alternatives to the current dispatch telecommunication operations within the Londonderry Police and Londonderry Fire. The town council, through Mr. Karen, commissioned police, firefighters, and telecommunicators to do some research and come up with recommendations on December, and they published their report on December 3rd, 2010. We'll talk about that more as we move through this presentation. Town Manager Karen explored the merger of the Londonderry Fire Department Dispatch and the Derry Fire Department Regional Communications Center. That report was published on June 30th, 2011. One of the results of that report was the submission of a citizen's petition, which was not certified, that was signed by 1,268 alleged residents of Londonderry, explaining their displeasure with the suggestion of a merger with Derry. Town Council took all this information to heart, and they formulated and made appointment and appointed members to the Londonderry Public Safety Dispatch Committee, hereinafter known as the committee, on September 26th in 2011. Committee members consisted of Town Councilor John Farrell, who served as our committee chair. Mr. John Veliquet served as our committee vice chair. Captain Doug Cardwell from the Londonderry Fire Department was a member at large. Lieutenant Tim Jones from the Londonderry Police was a member at large. Lisa Whitmore from the Budget Committee, a member at large. Steve Young, school committee member, was a member at large. Mr. Steve Chasen was our committee clerk. Ms. Linda Goodwin, a member at large. Ed Nolan, a member at large. And Mr. Bradley Osgood was an alternate, one of two alternates that were appointed, but he participated in every meeting. The committee's mission, as designated by Town Council, in essence and in summary, shall be to review and compare different public safety dispatch models and make recommendations to the Town Council whether to continue the current separate police and fire dispatch services or recommend a new model. Born out of that mission, the Town Council established eight duties and responsibilities. The fuel that drove the engine came from duties number five and six. Duty five was to study the costs, efficiencies, and public safety impacts of the current dispatch structure with various models to include combined dispatch services under the direction of the police department, combined dispatch services under the direction of the fire department, regional fire services under the direction of the fire department, regional police dispatch services under the direction of the police department, partnering with other public safety agencies to provide fire dispatch services, and partnering with other public safety agencies to provide police dispatch services. We'll get into these issues or these models at our conclusion. Duty number six was to engage any consultants to assist, if necessary, with the requirements to obtain budget clearance from the town manager. We'll talk a little bit about that in our recommendations at the end. As a result of our initial meeting and looking at the charge from the town council, the committee established an action plan, which was to review existing previous related analytical reports and studies, gain insight into the current dispatch and communication services provided by both the Londonderry PD and the Londonderry FD, utilizing presentations by representatives in their organizations on organization, operations, and technical data, and by tours where we could observe live operations, observe the physical layout, and observe the equipment in use. Then actually conduct Terry's a tour of the Derry Fire Department Communication Center and hold a discussion with their chief and other key personnel. Next on our action plan, we would review the previous Derry Town Council meeting where the intermunicipal agency, or an IMA, between Londonderry and Derry was reviewed and supported by their town council. Next in our action plan, we're to assess, clarify, and analyze all information gathered, and finally, develop a report of the committee's findings, observations, and recommendations for submission to the town council. The first study we looked at was provided by the Londonderry Combined Dispatch Analysis Consolidation Committee. That was a report published on 12/3/10. And in summary, the report talked about the initial startup costs to transfer the Londonderry Fire Department operations, communications, and dispatch equipment, they determined that the cost would be considerable. The part that struck most of us on the committee was that they interviewed representatives from three area communities that ran or belonged to either regional dispatch or they ran their own local combined dispatch. Goffstown and Merrimack indicated the combined operations provided an efficiency of operation. Amherst, which belonged to a regional communications called the Milford Area Communications Base, MAC base, was dissatisfied with the escalating costs of belonging to that organization. Amherst eventually withdrew from MAC base, designed and implemented their own autonomous local combined dispatch services, which is managed by a collaborative committee of fire, EMS, police, and so on within that community. Next, we review Town Manager Karen's proposal to consolidate fire EMS dispatch with the town of Derry, which this report was published on June 30th, 2011. What struck us was that it was probably one of the best analysis we've seen, speaking personally, that I've seen. It was comprehensive and in-depth and very informative. One of the other issues that we've seen, one of the other data points that we've seen in there, by entering into this IMA with Derry, Londonderry would save between $333,000 to $519,000 over a five-year contract period. This would amount to an annual average savings of $103,750. Mr. Carrot suggested that this savings could be utilized to bring the fire department up to their suggested staffing level of 10 firefighters per shift. Derry would also charge 180 local business owners who utilize alarm services an annual fee of $300, which amounted to a total of about $54,000 per year. Currently, they are not charged any fee by Londonderry. This targeted taxation on local businesses could have many negative consequences. Question we had, are we only realizing a $49,000 savings in essence, and are we also experiencing a loss of goodwill towards that demographic in the community? Within that report, Mr. Cameron's report, the Derry Fire Department Dispatch currently provides services to Derry, Auburn, Chester, Hampstead, and Windham. Londonderry and Salem are considering joining. Currently, client communities pay an annual $5,000 capital improvement fee and a 10% annual increase in their annual membership fee. Londonderry would be required to pay a 5% annual increase, but Londonderry Fire Department's modern equipment and technology would be transferred to Derry. Publication of this report had unforeseen negative reactions that resulted in that previously mentioned uncertified residents petition. Next, the next step in our action plan was to learn about our emergency services within Londonderry. Captain Doug Cardwell made a presentation to the committee on October 24, 2011, and the essence of his report is their dispatch to provide EMS and fire dispatch services to the community. Their dispatch is to provide a wide range of value-added services. That struck us as being extremely meaningful, and we asked Doug to expand upon that. He talked about that there's a lot of walk-in traffic, for example, and the dispatchers handle an essential part of the permitting process. There are a lot of people that come in with questions about when can you do your spring and fall burnings and so on. So they do provide a lot of clerical type of work in addition to their dispatch duties. They are skilled and experienced, and they're highly trained. Their training does include emergency medical dispatch training, which is unique The state 911 system trains their dispatchers, telecommunicators, and EMD. We'll see what happens later on with Derry as I move through the report. There is some value to this EMD training at this level, where if a local resident foregoes calling 911 and calls Londonderry Fire Department dispatch directly, they will get that higher level of service where they can analyze, diagnose a potential problem, and ensure that there is proper medical direction given and the proper services are dispatched to that location. Also, we found that the local fire dispatchers know the nuances of the town environment. They know hydrant locations, hazards, road widths, any hilly sections of the town that may prohibit certain equipment from traveling on those roads. They can find alternate routes quickly or alternative means of achieving the same goals. They also know many of the local residents and their specific medical needs. They also know the business community and any need to know information because of their experiences with those businesses. The tour of the fire department communication center revealed to the committee that it is equipped with up-to-date technological and communications equipment. They have two dispatch positions. However, the dispatch telecommunications area is extremely small and cramped in their outdated central facility. We also observed that it is non-ADA compliant, which means that if there was a renovation there, it would have to be brought into ADA compliance. There is one dispatcher per eight-hour shift. There are full-time and two part-time dispatchers working at the fire department. Also, some of Londonderry's fire department's firefighters are trained as dispatchers and can occasionally help if the calls coming in become overwhelming to the personnel on duty until another dispatcher can be brought on duty. Currently, the central station dispatches for all fire stations in Londonderry, and they average about 3,800 calls for service per year. Next, on November 14th in 2011, we met with Lieutenant Tim Jones of the Londonderry Fire Department, and his presentation described the comprehensive police services provided by the Londonderry PD. Please excuse the cut and paste line next. It should say dispatchers provide comprehensive, complex police dispatch services. Dispatchers, telecommunications provide a wide range of value-added services, as do the counterparts at the fire department. They provide a wider range of services to include handling a variety of walk-in traffic that range from people requesting permits to people requesting directions, to bringing registering complaints, to actually coming in and venting their level of anger, and it requires a certain level of skill to be able to de-escalate the situation until sworn officers can arrive on scene from either in the building or outside of the building to assist with those situations. They also work extensively with state mutual aid partners and so on. They are skilled, highly trained, and very experienced, and like their counterparts at the fire department, they knew the nuances of the town as well. A tour of the Londonderry Police Department Communications Center, we found they're up to date with technology and equipment. They have two full dispatch positions and space for a third position and a monitoring station in the supervisor's office. Their telecommunications dispatch area was very spacious. It appears to be about 66% larger than the fire department's dispatch center. We felt that this area could be expanded to accommodate a joint local dispatch operation, but it would require considerable study and work would be required to achieve the goals we'll talk about in a little bit. They currently have one dispatcher assigned to the day shift. There are two to the afternoon shift, and one dispatcher works the overnights. They have currently six full-time telecommunicators. The Londonderry Police Department handles about 25,000 calls for service per year, an unknown number of walk-in traffic, and about 15,000 calls from patrol officers providing and or requesting information from dispatch. One of the issues that we became concerned with is that there was a high level of activity taking place in that dispatch, in that police dispatch area, particularly when you have two dispatchers working. And there is that possibility of crosstalk pollution when, for example, somebody is taking information coming in on a call and somebody is, another dispatcher may be broadcasting on the radio. There is always that possibility that you're hearing the background noise either from radio calls coming in or radio calls going out and somebody being on the phone. Crosstalk issues would be compounded if the fire department were located there without significant modifications being made. Fire department, we're talking apples and oranges about the type of calls for service. And many times, police and fire will receive the same calls for the same type of incident, but the requirements of services rendered and information being gathered may be significantly different. And that could lend to an area of confusion if proper mitigating steps weren't taken. On November 29, 2011, we toured the Derry Fire Communications Center. We were met by Chief Klauber and the Director of Communications, Mr. Goldman. They provided us an informative tour of the Derry Fire Department's Communications Center. They also let us make observations, and they responded to our questions. Their center is significantly larger than the Londonderry Fire Department's dispatch center, but it is also significantly smaller than the Londonderry Police Department's dispatch center. The equipment they're using is current and meets professional standards. There is multiple layers of redundancy in their system. They have backup communications at their general headquarters, and they have backup communications at their police department. And if Londonderry were to join, they were talking about the possibility of a backup communication plan being put in place with the Londonderry Police Department. Currently, the center has two full-functioning answering dispatch points with the potential for a third. The center is staffed with two telecommunicators during the day and afternoon shifts and one on the overnight tour. Mr. Goldman, the director, jumps in to assist when necessary when he's working. The center's goal is to have a second telecommuter on the overnight tour. Their dispatcher telecommunicators are experienced, they're highly trained and skilled, but there is a difference between them and what is provided by Londonderry in that Londonderry's fire department's dispatchers are EMD trained. And some people look at that as a positive, some look at it as a negative. I think the personal opinion is that it's a value-added service to the residents of Londonderry. When asked about crosstalk concerns, Mr. Goldman felt that this issue could be handled by dispatchers using earphones. He went on to say that they'd never experienced any crosstalk issues and never experienced any mix-ups involving confused calls from client towns. For example, Kelly Ave in Windham and Kelly Ave in Auburn, for example. They have separate phones that ring for each community, and that alerts them as to which town they are responding to. They also explain that if they have any kind of an issue that can lead to confusion, they ask clarifying questions and will call back their community for verification. They reaffirmed the number of communities that they are currently serving and also reaffirmed the fact that Londonderry and Salem were considering becoming client members of that organization. Chief Klauber advised that the combined estimated total calls for service for the present and proposed clients would not exceed 12,000 calls annually. which is the expected number for the estimated population of the client town and proposed client towns to be served, which is 70,000 residents. According to Chief Klauber, the professional standards indicate that the Derry Fire Dispatch Center can handle that anticipated volume under the current staffing levels. Another issue that came up during the conversation was that all Londonderry Fire Department dispatch service equipment, software, and data would be transferred to the Derry Fire Department Communication Center. So what's currently that equipment, state-of-the-art equipment at the fire department locally, would be transferred into the custody of the Derry Fire Department. We also asked about that $5,000 capital improvement fee. Chief Klauber advised that for this current fiscal year, they would be looking at software upgrades to help provide a more efficient service and records keeping. He also explained that Derry absorbs any capital improvements that are made and then passes on those costs to client communities when their contracts are renewed. He also stated that the Derry Fire Department Communication Center, though larger, well, this is an observation, the Derry Fire Department Communication Center, though larger than the LFD Center, is still small, in the committee's opinion, would likely need to undergo an expansion in the future to handle additional clients, equipment, and et cetera. That et cetera, when we began to explore the potential growth in each of the client communities, that's a major unknown, and that could have a significant increase on infrastructure, demand for services, and certainly that could raise that call volume significantly higher than the 12,000 anticipated current and proposed clients. Next, we reviewed a DVD of a Derry Town Council meeting in which they brought up the IMA. The meeting was held, we made the observation of this DVD on May 3rd, 2011. It was Derry Town Council agenda item 11-48. And it was, I'm sorry, their meeting, Derry's meeting took place on May 3rd, 2011. And it was agenda item 1148, and they brought up the proposed IMA for Derry to provide fire and medical dispatch services to the town of Londonderry. A couple of the bulleted points that we picked out of this, observing this meeting, was that the Derry Town Council felt that both communities would experience dollar savings and increased efficiencies. One town council suggested that Derry Fire Department would be able to provide better services to all clients than in the past because there would be two communicators working 24 hours per day versus the current one. Chief Klauber, during that meeting, responding to a question by a town councilor, discussed the town council's goals of seeking outside dollars for the operation of the Derry Fire Department Communication Center rather than using Derry tax dollars. The chief feels that they have achieved this goal in part by renegotiating client contracts that contain a 10% annual fee increase and an annual $5,000 assessment for capital improvements. The chief discussed the potential positive impact of charging Londonderry alarm service subscribers at an annual fee of $300 and also the annual membership fee increase would be 5%. He felt that this would be a positive, would provide a positive net revenue for Derry. The Derry Town Council voted unanimously to accept the proposed intermunicipal agency agreement. Some of the known and potential growth impacts that could impact certainly Derry and Londonderry would be the RW Highway, which is the new access egress to the airport. That's going to open up the potential for finishing off Pettingill Road and open up that area for development. Also, Woodmont, the multi-use development, we just don't know what impact that's going to have. Certainly, if the proposed Exit 4A project for Route 93 is eventually approved, it'll open up additional land for development in Londonderry and Derry. And we have no idea what's taking place in Auburn, Chester, Windham, but we do know that there is sustained growth in southern New Hampshire, so likely those communities will experience some level of growth that will have an impact on those calls for service totals that Chief Calabro was referring to. The committee developed a consensus relative to two duties, number 5 and 6. The first duty, to look at different models, duty 5, was to combine dispatch service under the direction of the Londonderry Police Department. The consensus was an 8-to-1 consensus that it may be feasible in the future. The next model looked at was the combined dispatch service under the direction of the Londonderry Fire Department. We felt that that may be feasible in the future as well. A regional fire dispatch service under the direction of the fire department, that may be feasible. And a regional police dispatch services under the direction of the Londonderry Police Department, that may be feasible in the future as well. Model number 5, partnering with other public safety agencies to provide fire dispatch services. The 8-to-1 consensus would not serve the best interests of the residents of Londonderry, though there is agreement that regionalization can and has worked throughout the state. Partnering, number 6, partnering with other public safety agencies to provide police dispatch services. Again, this would not serve the best interests of the residents of Londonderry. Again, there is agreement that regionalization can and has worked in this area as well. And then duty number 6, which referred to hiring consultants, we'll talk about in our recommendations. The committee's recommendations to the town council are as follows. The committee in general believes that until the economy will support a professional in-depth needs assessment, which can include an analysis of community needs, an analysis of the various tasks that are provided by both agencies, public safety agencies, to include conceptual designs. Within that assessment, the committee recommends retaining the current dispatch communications model employed by the Londonderry Fire Department and the Londonderry Police Department. When the economy supports such a comprehensive study, the committee recommends that the consultant company or companies focus on at least two areas. One, developing a combined community communications dispatch center similar to the Amherst model, and second, the alternative would be to develop a second model that will provide the town of Londonderry dispatch center the means and opportunity to become a regional combined dispatch center, bringing in clients and revenue to the town of Londonderry. The committee believes that in either case, a standalone facility should be considered. This model is preferable to having it housed in either the Londonderry Fire Department or the Londonderry Police Department. The professional study and plan should be conducted by specialized firms such as, but not limited to the following. These are only examples of companies that provide these types of services. JFK Systems, LLC, Emergency Communication Consulting Services, Web Consulting Services, Public Safety Consultants. We're sure there are many more, but these are the two that we found. The committee respectfully asks the town council to retain or reconvene the present committee to oversee the above recommendations when the feasibility of the project is appropriate. And finally, while the majority of the committee in an 8-to-1 consensus believes that fire dispatch should stay in Londonderry today, the town council should strive towards a future regionalized public safety dispatch center. The preference is that it should be in Londonderry. An alternative location is acceptable with Londonderry as a partner in the operation. And that's the slideshow.
All right. Very well done. Very well done.
So, and serving as the chairman, what became very interesting was that you became a facilitator and pretty much got taken over by the committee And in my particular case, I stepped away from the presentation and also did not offer any input as far as opinions when the committee, you'll see in their report, each member offered their opinions. I felt it was in the best interest of the council if I refrained. A couple of things that we learned that was outside of dispatch, something I shared with Dave is Derry does a far greater job at collecting their ambulance revenues. I think we learned some lessons from that, and we're talking to Derry about doing a better job of collecting our revenues. So some good came out of it. The other thing that was really interesting is that, I may have shared this in the past, is that we were standing in the dispatch center, and a call for one of the communities came in for chest pains. It took, and this particular community, without naming it, uses contract ambulance. It took them 7 minutes to find the ambulance to dispatch it, and then 12 additional minutes for it to arrive. So it was 19 minutes before they arrived for a patient with chest pains. And I think I've been told our average response is between 4 and 7 minutes. I'm getting a yes from the back of the room. So a couple things we learned, something we didn't know. Chief Calabro did it. They run a very good organization over there from a dispatch center standpoint. It was very similar to what you know, Officer Jones runs over here in Londonderry. It's quiet, it's professional, it conducts itself, you know, well. You can see that they talk to each other. What was amazing about these dispatch centers is how quiet they were all the time, and how in control the dispatcher is at all times, no matter what call they were handling. Because we did handle, I think we were in Londonderry for about a half an hour in the police one, and there was a lot of activity going on at the time. So it was interesting. I mean, and the committee, I mean, they really dug in. So it was a very interesting exercise. So as the chairman, thank you, committee.
Very good. Any other questions from the council?
No, I just wanted to thank everybody for their time and effort that was put into this. You can tell in following some of the videos that we had, and you can tell by the presentation that a lot of time and effort was put into this and a lot of thoughtfulness, so I appreciate it very much by all of you. Thank you.
Yeah, I'd like to thank you. And one of the things that I learned from reading it, which, you know, even though I've been to a couple of the dispatch centers, was the problem of crosstalk. It never even dawned on me, because most of the time when I was there, nothing really happened. But yeah, I guess it's significant problem, and which, at least for Londonderry, is going to mean building a different facility at some point. So it was
within the existing buildings.
Well, that's
certainly would be a possibility. I mean, yeah. You know, you could also handle this a lot like the auditorium talk of all these years. I mean, if you could get the right level of sponsorship. You know, maybe the dispatch center belongs in a different place. And, you know, so that it can, because if it's going to have a multifunction of serving the community, then we got to look at where the community is going to be. And if there's going to be walk-up traffic, maybe we need to take that into consideration. But there's a lot more to this than I think any of us understood when we got into it.
Yeah,
sure. Yeah, there is. Well, I'd like to thank the committee for the 8-1. I think it is in agreement with a lot of the concerns that people had when we had brought this up. It was well received. I appreciate everybody's dedication to getting it, you know, a fair and honest assessment of what we got going on. And well done. And thank you very much for your time and effort for everybody.
Thank you, Mr.
Chairman. I would like to point out for reference that in the official written report and in our minutes, there are specific paragraphs of observations and feelings attributed to each one of the committee members. So here where we say consensus of, you know, we're trying to just encapsulate these things to give you the idea of it, but the public is certainly welcome to go look at that and see if there's any other, you know, this person focused on that and brought to our attention and somebody else saw this.
I think that's probably something we can actually put on the website, Dave.
Sure, absolutely.
Yeah. So that'd be great.
It's probably in the... in this presentation here, I think.
Right, mm-hmm. We have
yep.
it.
Yep, yep.
I actually had a question, Jim.
Anyway, it's there for reference, so it's transparent.
Thanks, John.
I didn't know if any of the in-depth analysis that you did uncovered anything as far as getting some sort of a state a local aid or grant for some kind of a standalone emergency dispatch center?
No, sir, we didn't look into that.
I wonder if that's something that could be looked into.
That's part of the next step.
While you have recommended that we wait until the economy is better, we've just been through the budget process and council as a whole worked very, very diligently to keep the tax rate as low as possible. I, as one councilor, still feel that single dispatch is very unsafe. And I think through your analysis and even talking to the captain in Derry, him saying that he wants to make sure that there's two people on at all times speaks volumes. And anything that you do as far as researching this single dispatch, it is risky business. So, I for one want to not wait 6 months to a year to try to get the ball rolling. I want to see how we can move this forward. Yep.
Mr. Green, I think that the best source of finding out about any federal or state grants would be through your public safety department heads, who would have access or actual knowledge if there is anything out there available. I know from my experience in Massachusetts that federal funding was drying up for most suburban communities, and it was being channeled into your cities. 911 is operated somewhat differently in Massachusetts, significantly differently in Massachusetts than New Hampshire, where there's a phenomenal amount of revenues generated that go into a collective special revenue account for the state telecommunication board, which is then passed out to local communities. But what I've seen over the last couple of years in Mass is they're focusing now on regionalized dispatch in Massachusetts. So a lot of that money that was being channeled to the local communities is now you're being encouraged to look at regionalization in order to qualify for funding. But your best source of information on external funding sources from the federal government or the state are going to be your department heads from public safety.
So is there a way, Mr. Chairman, that we could instruct the town manager to look into the possibility of federal safety grants, if you could instruct?
I think, going to what Joe said, I think we kind of already do that, isn't it?
There's your grant guy.
I was just going to say.
I'll jump in here. Doug
jump in.
All the communication money for the state of New Hampshire federally is received by the state. Just before September 11th, they were working on a statewide radio network. And when the Homeland Security grant started coming down, they accepted it for all the communities. We petitioned the state. You know, it's a competitive grant process. Most of that money's gone. Right. We haven't been seeing it. We're fortunate. We have transmitters, dispatch centers, or consoles that have come from the state, but that money's pretty much dried up at this point.
Okay. So there's your answer, John.
So there's no. are you saying that you're just not? You've been trying to get these grants and they're just dried up, or is there a possibility of continuing to try to get the grants to see if there's
there was money available?
Okay.
We did receive money, and but so there's the no money more. Is okay. No longer there.
I think the biggest shot in the arm we had from that whole stimulus was the fire department in the north side. That's a pretty big chunk of cash.
I mean, you remember the SAFER grant that we went through last year for staffing. Mm-hmm. I mean, we were a qualified candidate, but they're just not funding there.
Right. So. If I may, one more question.
Yeah.
So one of the things I was speaking to another captain in the fire department here was that this becomes almost a business proposition for the town of Londonderry. Similarly, you could see by the council of Derry and their willingness to jump ahead. This is another form, in my opinion, of not only increasing, this is a win-win situation for Londonderry, not only increasing the ability for us to service the town in a safer way by a regionalization process, but also by making some more ambulance services maybe being regionalized as well out to other towns. This is an income proposition for us. So we got to kind of look at it from the aspect of, the investment, the short-term investment for the long-term savings. And I just, wanted to at least send that out to the rest of the council and not lose sight of the fact that If we just let this lie, and I'm not saying we're going to, but if we just kind of let this lie and kind of wait around for 6 months, a year, or 2 years, we may lose an opportunity that I think is knocking on our door, especially in the ambulance sector. So, anyway.
Any other questions? All right. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. We really do. Okay. Still in public comment. I think this is the longest public comment we've ever had. Andre, economic development update.
Should be short. You only did part of it already, right?
Yeah.
But I'll start here, and then I'll move over there for the latter part of my presentation. Again, my name is Andre Guerin. I'm the Community Development Director. Wanted to give the Town Council an update on the economic development activities. And the reason was somewhat related to economic development, but as an update regarding the master plan. As the board may know, that the master plan committee, as well as the planning board, selected a consultant to assist it with the board in the creation of a comprehensive master plan. The consultant selected was Town Planning Urban Design Collaborative, or TPUDC, out of Tennessee. They were hired, and we recently completed the contract negotiation with them, so we're off and running there. The Master Plan Steering Committee has created a subcommittee in order to help with the creation of the survey that we contracted UNH Survey Center to help us with. And I know that committee is meeting on Thursday. It is our hopes to have the survey completed by our Master Plan Steering Committee's meeting on the 28th that conduct the actual survey the first part of April. Woodmont, I won't get too far into that, we discussed a whole lot of that, but as the board knows, the consultant was selected for that project, Howard Stein Hudson Associates, along with Icon Architecture and RKG Associates, as the team that will represent the planning board as this third-party review consultant. Part of your packet is a survey that was completed this past summer of the airport area businesses. And we had hired a intern by the name of Jeff Belanger. That internship was paid for by the Londonderry Housing and Redevelopment Authority because the internship, at least the project that the intern was taking part of, was for the airport area, which is consistent with their charge and their target area. So you have the results of that survey. Jeff did a fantastic job in putting this together, identifying the businesses that are there. We got a pretty good response out of the close to 100 businesses in the airport area. I believe 35 the 40 of the businesses responded to our survey, which is statistically it's great to have that much of a response. We were hoping for higher, but we're pleased with the response that we've received. And you'll see, what was the results of that. I think just as a one element of that is that as the community kind of intuitively felt that majority of the type of businesses out in the airport area are manufacturing and represents about 40%. And Londonderry, compared to the state, has a high share of manufacturers, within its borders. Given that manufacturing is seeing a slow decline in New Hampshire,
we're seeing a slight increase in Londonderry. So that's a good thing. And obviously with the emphasis on manufacturers being our federal goal, it's good to have those types of entities in Londonderry. Before I move on to the projects, any questions regarding that first part, projects?
Good statistics. He did a very good job putting this together.
Jeff Melanger, he is a graduate candidate at Harvard University, and we're fortunate to get him. He's also has his law degree.
I've seen a ton of these in my life, and this is really well done.
Yeah. Again, he did a fantastic job.
I just thank them.
As far as project funding projects, Pettengill Road, you may have heard that there is another round of Tiger funding out, which is Tiger 4. Londonderry had submitted for the three subsequent rounds or preceding rounds of Tiger 1, 2, and 3. Unfortunately, we were unsuccessful with regard to that. And Congressman Genta's representative Sean Thomas has indicated that obviously the Pettengill Road is a priority of the congressman, as well as others. It should be indicated that I know that the Manchester Chamber of Commerce is very interested in getting the Pettengill Road project in Londonderry, as well as the Londonderry Dairy Chamber of Commerce is interested in that, as well as our local delegation. And what our conversation with Mr. Thomas was that DOT was going to help us package a package together, but in our conversation with DOT as well as Sean Thomas, we indicated that we should not submit an application this time around, given that we don't have our 20% match. One of the things that came out of the Tiger 1, 2, and 3 was that the successful projects were ones that had greater than 20% of their match. Matter of fact, it's more around 40% of their match. I know Dave has indicated to our delegation that probably the problem with town municipalities is that you cannot get a bond in advance of going for public funding such as this. And we're hoping to have or at least to have a discussion at the federal level to allow those a window for towns like us, and not only in Londonderry, but the towns around the country, that if we had the funding or if that funding can be contingent upon a window opportunity to allow a community to get its share appropriated, then we probably bode a little bit better for communities such as ours. So I know that DOT is interested in this project. I know that there's a lot of support out there for that. If there is another round of this and we're in a position where we can, and that particular issue can be addressed, then obviously we would move forward with that funding application. Obviously everybody wants a successful application. I know we do. We tried three times, and I know that was one of the key elements, is that to have that 20% match. Conversely, on the EDA funding, that is something that we do want to resubmit. There's a lot of interest in that application
excuse
as well.
Me.
And the EDA stands for
excuse sorry. Me. So maybe I didn't hear you correct. So you're not applying for Tiger funding because we don't have the 20% match? That was the recommendation?
Correct.
Just so you know, I actually did approach the airport director. He went to the FAA to see if there was a way that we could work something out with the airport, since they're one of the landowners, to see if we could come up with a way around it. And the FAA said no.
But if we're not applying for it, that's a sure way of not getting it, right?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, if we don't apply for it, you're correct. We don't have a stand chance of getting anything if we don't apply. But on the other hand, we submitted three applications prior to that, and every time we were unsuccessful because we didn't even have close to our 20% match. We have no roadway money towards this. We have sewer money, which gives me to my second part, which is the Economic Development Administration grant, We do have sewer money available, which, matter of fact, we have our 50% match there. With regard to the roadway itself, that has always been the feedback, is that you have no money towards your, you have nothing towards your roadway right now. You have no money, and we can't use money that we already spent, meaning that we appropriated $265,000 back in 2002 to do the engineering. But right now, we have $0 towards this project for the roadway aspect of it.
So obviously, Pittenagill is a Londonderry road, but Pittenagill is kind of the key to opening up the area that would benefit Bedford, Manchester, Merrimack, Litchfield. I could go on and on, because it would affect everybody in a very good way, eventually,
yes,
if it opens up. So why aren't we reaching out to those communities and saying, you know, you want us... kind of make it a regional proposition. I mean, why isn't that something that we couldn't look at?
Well, we are, but not, we are on a regional basis. That's why we're working with a congressman. We had a conference call with some NHDOT officials and Representative Ginther's office, and the feedback we received was the average local match for a successful Tiger grant was 43% nationwide. And, you know, DOT was interested in partnering with us, but they knew that we didn't have a local match, and unfortunately, neither does the state. That's why the state's only going for one project, which is a railroad project, and the railroad owner has had a local match. One issue we tried to have the representative work in Congress is to allow conditional grants, whereby you could apply without the match in hand, but you'd have about 120 days to comply with the grant requirements. So, you know, I feel a lot more comfortable going to the voters for a bond issue. If we knew we had X number of dollars sitting on the shelf waiting for Londonderry, for Pettingill Road, if we had to raise a much smaller amount.
So is that where staff is working at right now?
So that's what we're currently communicating with Representative Ginther's office to see if they can consider changes at the federal level with respect to matching grants. That's a problem not only with Londonderry, it's a problem with predominantly New England, New England town meeting form of government. And you know, there's nothing which legally precludes us from going to town meeting looking for a matching grant for an anticipated grant, but you don't know the amount you're going to need. And also, you know, folks are understandably very reluctant to raise money for a potential grant. So, you know, it's difficult decisions we have to make. So those are the paths we're looking at to attempt to recognize that the road has regional benefits. And so, you know, if the benefits are going to be shared, then the cost will be shared as well. So right. That's what we're working on.
Understood. Okay.
If you wanted, what would 43% be as far as a number? What would you be looking for in a bond?
Well, if we receive the ADA funds, then 43% would be about $3.5 million.
Well, you know, we carry a bond on our books, even though we don't have a bond, which is Exit 4A,
mm-hmm.
because of, you know. Why couldn't you do a similar thing like that and see if the voters would authorize it, but until we conditionally get...
That is definitely an option we have. It's just that I think we've all experienced whereby it's more... It's more difficult receiving approval if the first one or two or three efforts fail. So, but you know, if the council wants to look at that option, that's definitely something I'd be interested in pursuing.
I mean, it doesn't cost us anything unless we actually, you know, take the authorization. And
That's correct. So those are the different areas we're looking at to make sure that the cost of the project matches the benefits of the project. So it's more, like I said, you're absolutely right. It's more local, it's more regional, so we're trying to make sure that we spread out those costs appropriately.
So to that point, you know, maybe the next council would be able to do something with that.
We're actually going to have a meeting with the DOT officials probably in the next couple months to further refine these ideas, and we'll keep the council in loop as to what the potential options are, how they may impact Londonderry with bonding and other financial options.
Okay. Joe, do you have anything else?
I was just going to ask the same question. How much is 43%? But why are we putting down 20%? Because that's the minimum that you have to have.
Yeah.
And what Dave's saying is that the successful grants are the 43%.
Yeah.
Okay,
Andre.
Further above that is the elevator. Conversely, with regard to the Economic Development Administration grant, that is something that, and that, if the board remembers, will as part of, is the $4.3 million part of the $12.3 million project, and that's the sewer aspect to build the sewer pump station as well as the lines associated with the project. And that is something that we do have matching funds for, which the EDA requires a 50-50 match. And therefore, you know, we do have the money in there, and we're planning on resubmitting. When we, when Dave and I met with Regional Director Willie Taylor, one of the things that he indicated is that it always greatly enhances a project if you have a bird in hand or the likelihood of a bird in hand coming as a result of the project. And as the board well knows, between 2007 and 2009, you can hear the echo of your voice out there, you know, crying for the for businesses to come to your area. Now we're, you know, we're getting some good inquiries, and not only in Londonderry, but I know that you know, some of the towns in the region are starting to get inquiries. The good position that Londonderry is in is that we have available land, we have good infrastructure. So all that leads to, there seems to be some good opportunities out in the airport area. And so hopefully some of those ideas we can translate into somebody either coming, or there's an inclination that they will come, provided that there's adequate infrastructure there. So if we can use any one of those things in order to enhance our application, I think we can be successful there. And that's the key thing. I'd just love to see one of those applications play off. Getting into prospects, I'm very, very happy to report to the board is with regard to the first prospect, which is American Tire Distributors. They recently submitted a application for a project off of Jacksbridge Road. It's 125,000 square feet. About this time last year, that came in from the from DRED, Department of Resource Economic Development, as a potential. That there's some site selectors looking in the southern New Hampshire region. You might want to reach out to this particular person, and which I did, and met with the site selector and the owner of the, or actually one of the principals of the organization, and basically took them around Londonderry areas to sites that met their need. And they came out this time last year, and we had some pretty good meetings, and then when they left, it was just a matter of continuing to feed them information about Londonderry and the benefits and some of the things that Londonderry had going on and some of the advantages of locating their business in Londonderry. There was a time during late summer where, you know, this wasn't too a lot of correspondence back and forth, and so we just kind of launched our own little drip campaign and said, you know, there's some other things you might not have heard about Londonderry that we thought that, you know, you might find advantageous to your business. But lo and behold, in October, we met, they sent their engineering crew out as well as their construction crew. And since that time, everything has been put in motion. Right now, they're scheduled to go before the planning board on April 4th, hopefully for an approval. I got to admit that this group, Cole Engineering, has done a fantastic group. They're now they're also working with a local survey firm, but you know, they are from based in St. Louis, Missouri. Been doing a bang up job with regard to dotting their I's and crossing their T's with regard to the project out there, and right now I think we're on a road towards success. So that is something that you know, we nurtured, and it looks like it's going to bear fruit for Londonderry.
Great.
Also, we're working in that same area, now across the street on Vista Ridge and Vista Ridge and Route 28. I'm working with a developer that's proposing 109,000 square feet retail center near Vista Ridge and Route 28. It's a result of the zoning change that we made over there in mixed use development, and that's exactly what is being presented. And that is also on track for a hearing on April 4th before the board. So hopefully that will bear fruit as well. The board remembers earlier, actually about this time last year, we heard a rezoning request for this particular project, Fraser Warehouse off of Route 28, and that was to rezone it from C2 to industrial to help facilitate the expansion of that project. The rezoning took place, the site plan was approved, and now the 82,000 square foot expansion is close to completion. I had a discussion with Ed Doherty last week, and it indicated that everything is going according to plan and that they're looking to open soon. At least their warehouse portion has been in use for the last, I would say, about 4 to 5 months. The office part of it is now close to completion. Hopefully they'll get a CO on that soon. Another expansion in Londonderry was the Executive Health Club. Mike Benton, who is the owner of the Executive Health Club, had made plans to utilize a piece of land in Bedford to move their operation to Bedford. Through working with the airport as well as staff, you know, they opted to stay put. I think Mike Benton felt that right now the identity of the Executive Health Club has been well positioned where it is right now. Obviously, with the opening of the airport access road, it opened up a whole lot of opportunities for him as well. And so they're moving forward with expansion. That the approval for that happened in March, not March, but in February. The plan was signed, and they're off and running. They're going to be expanding, opening up, or creating wellness offices internally. Utilizing the, the second floor on top of the, what used to be the racquetball courts are going to be converted to offices. Externally, they're going to be adding outdoor pool and a kiddie pool expansion, and also adding outdoor tennis courts. And so, is this another business in Londonderry that chose to expand in place as opposed to moving? Their new gas station opened up at the corner of Liberty Drive and Route 28. And I don't know if you've been by there throughout the last several months, but I couldn't believe how quickly that went up. But it went up very quickly. And they're open for business. That is a gas station convenience store, about 3,740 square feet. I had the opportunity last year in November to be invited to a tour of a facility right on the Manchester Londonderry Town line on Bouchard Street called Textile Coating International. A gentleman by the name of Ed Fichette was kind enough to give me a tour of that facility. It's a fascinating manufacturing. That is actually the manufacturing part of the facility is in Manchester. The warehouse element of their facility is in Londonderry. And they recently purchased 7 Delta Drive for the expansion of their operation. I think initially they're going to use that for warehousing and distribution. But hopefully in the future, those chains and they'll have maybe a more expanded use for that facility. But obviously, I'm very encouraged with the fact that they did purchase a building in Londonderry for that purpose. Also attended a few ribbon cuttings. Sister Shops in Crossroad Mall opened up. I think they deal with, actually they do deal with antiquities, as well as I was able to participate in the a ribbon cutting for Ironworks Personal Training Studio at 25 National Road. That's right near the southbound on-ramp out near Exit 4. And pretty nice place there. Also had a chance to stop by the Renewable Trading Company, which is off of 3 Rockingham Road. If you remember, it was the old furniture building, Wayside Furniture Building, before you get into Derry. That's been converted into a consignment shop. And it's like when I went there, it's almost like the Jordan's Furniture of consignment shop. Everything is immaculate in that place, well laid out, and items for purchase, and they're well displayed. I mean, it's just a phenomenal place. I had a chance to meet Kevin and his mother, Aunt Patty, and I know a few of the counselors have been by there, and they mentioned that, and they appreciate the you coming. But Once I was made aware of that, I definitely want to stop by and say hello to them, and nice business they have in town. And also, within the last several months, a business by the name of Barb's Beer Emporium opened up in the new Mr. Steers complex over there. Being a beer drinker, love the place. Phenomenal. Phenomenal.
Isn't there a new restaurant going in soon?
Soon, yeah. And I believe it's going to be a pub type of place that's going to locate actually right next to the Barb's Beer Emporium. And hopefully that will, you know, will take place soon. Before I get to the Macready website, I just want to update you on a meeting held in this room back in January with the Derry Londonderry Chamber and the Hudson Chamber of Commerce. And that was this brought about just to invite some of the area planners of Hudson, Litchfield, Derry, and Londonderry. Just to give the area, just to give the chambers, just an update of what's going on in our respective communities. It was well attended, and I think everybody benefited from the information from all the planners that were involved. Grubb and Ellis will be holding its third annual Manchester Boston Regional Airport update meeting, and that's going to take place, I believe, at the airport. And I've been asked to speak on the Pettengill Road project, and also, which is not on your list, but is I think it's relevant. The Metro Center, which is a regional kind of economic development action group, born out of the Southern Hampshire Planning Commission, held a meeting back in January to create a new strategic plan for the region. And obviously, Londonderry participated in that, and hopefully, a new action plan will be a result from that. And if I can go over real quickly to the laptop, I can show you some of the additions made to the website.
Hey, John.
Thank you, John.
When you read a ride.
Actually, I can use this site. What I'm pulling up is the Thriving Londonderry site. I just want to point out quickly three new additions. One being the new site pictured out front. This picture on the left here used to be consumed this whole frame here. And what we did is condense it down at a Londonderry business building here, as well as just a regional map of where Londonderry is as it relates to Mass and New Hampshire. And again, all three things that in discussion with site selectors and economic development groups and peers that, you know, as far as information, what are people look for, and at least from the front page, is something that lists clearly identifies where Londonderry is compared to other states in the region. Although we also, you know, we also put a bigger and more clear regional map up there that John Vogel helped me create, and we put on there, which reaches obviously down into Boston, so people can see where Londonderry in relation to the region, as well as Maine as well.
Who designed the site?
The site was designed was by Servitech, and our also Gary O'Neill, who helped us put together the branding part of that. So this is, nothing's changed from that original launch that was done a few years ago, other than this updates some of the information on the site. What's the one of the biggest changes that were made is that we put this site finder tool here, and hopefully that will come up here, working with a group called Catalyst. And what that allows us to do is search and find all Londonderry relevant information you see on that search property listing, meaning that if you click on office and you put on search, it'll provide all the office units available for rent or for purchase or lease in Londonderry only. And it provides you a list as well as where it is, the cost, and who the contact person relative to these properties. That's one of the responses that I got from people who are inquiring about land in Londonderry. Wanted to know as to what's available from all elements: vacant land, occupied, office occupied land, industrial occupied land. How big it is, how much they want for it, where it is, and so on and so forth. This particular site will provide that information. The other aspect of this is that now this site can be, at least we created several pages that can now be viewed on PDAs. So if you have an iPhone or BlackBerry, now that this site can be viewed in that reduced screen, and still provide you with with information regarding Londonderry, and also a link to the main site, so you still have the full breadth of the main site. But there's been about 10 pages created in order to be PDA accessible. And those are really the key elements. There are several smaller things that took place in there, but those are the significant changes made to the site. And also with the promise to the board to do a better job of keeping the news element of this site up to speed. We always try to maintain at least the facts and figures and all those type of things as new information comes with regard to, obviously, the census information came. We took that information, we update the facts and figures, but with particular the news items on the site, against that, we'll do definitely a better job of getting that information up and going. Between August and now, as you well know, there's been a lot that has taken place within our department, and might be able to make sure I prioritize and get some of those bigger projects done. That's one of the things that I've neglected, but I hopefully that now that things are starting to get back on track, I can still put my my time back into making sure this site is up to speed.
Andre, can I ask a question now?
Sure.
So on this current projects list, if you click on it, like as an example, the
which one?
Area, the current projects list.
A project underway?
Yeah.
All right.
So if we know as an example from previous meetings, we talked about the Elliott project going across the street.
Yes.
And then when that's supposed to go ahead, and it's really there's nothing on that. Is that something that is it's because it's not groundbroken yet or?
What we try to do with project underway is keep because these are probably the three most recent projects that have taken place. We can keep kind of a list of things going on, but what we try to do is just keep up with the most recent projects.
So
the
Elliott. You can't keep a list, you said?
We can. Oh, okay. We can put as many of these on there. It's just what we try to do is this. We know that the Londonderry freezer warehouse within the last year that took place. The Rockingham Liberty, the gas station convenience store happened within the last several months, and the yogurt. State for yogurt, I know they recently came back into the board to reconfigure their phase one and phase two of their project, so we put that on. But there's nothing prevents us from adding as many as we want. It's just the Elliott, I know that was approved probably 2 years ago.
Yeah.
It's just that, and talking with the developer, they don't anticipate getting started with that project. Although they're coming in soon for a sign for the site, they don't anticipate getting started with that to a part of the latter part of this year.
Okay. Well, this is just a comment from somebody that's not in, you know, your job or town management job, just from an outsider and a new councilor at that. When you drive around Londonderry and you see trees going down and you see, you know, earth being dug up, you know, you want people to be able to go to this site as a useful site and look at that. So it needs to be as complete as possible. I would think that any type of construction, you know, I would ask that it be fulfilled or at least be, you know, listed here so that people could, you know, if they're wondering about it, they could go out and look and just see. I think that would be important. The only other comment I had is on the, since we're talking about this, Londonderry business is good. When you go on our front part of our website and you have that symbol on the bottom, there's really nothing, unless you bring your cursor over to it, nothing that says click on this. I mean,
symbol on the bottom. Wait.
Yeah. So if you went all the way out to the main.
This is the main page.
No, our main page.
Okay.
To get over to this, this is good. Okay. So down at the bottom, if you just look at that and you're looking to try to get into it, you didn't, you know, notice the symbol. It doesn't say, like, I would think the Londonderry business is good, life is better should be underneath it, and maybe something that dummy proof that says click here for, you know, some kind of a link. It really does. I mean, I passed this 100 times until somebody had to tell me, yeah, just click on the apple. What do you mean clicking on the apple? And I'm clicking the apple on the left-hand side here like a dummy. It really, I mean, you know it because it's there, but nobody would know to click on that. It's really hard. So gotcha. I'm just, as an outside opinion, just to have a notation to get into it. I mean, if I'm this involved and I go onto the website looking for it specifically and I get lost. I can imagine some other people are. I consider myself somewhat computer savvy, but that, unless you put your cursor over it, it just doesn't tell you it's a link. So, or at least it does the same thing as assisting programs where it's underlined, etc.
Gotcha. That's all I have for you tonight.
No, I don't have any questions.
Okay. John?
All set.
And I just wanted to make one more comment, then.
Yeah.
I just, I know this time last year, I'd asked you to have some of the things of what we've done in the past year, and so I appreciate you putting those on there and, you know, being able to kind of look at it and say, hey, as a scorecard, you know, as each department, we look at the number of calls in the fire department, we look at the number of, you know, fires, et cetera. We just look at it as kind of a scorecard, so I appreciate the fact that these are here. I just had one question. Are these items that people just kind of give you a call, or is it, like, how do we get these people? I mean, I'm trying to learn more about how we get people in. I mean, I guess the second page where you go to these Derry Chambers of Commerce and you go to the Metro Centers, I guess that's how you get the leads, to have people kind of come in and visit, or, I mean, you call, cold call. I mean, these seem to be people that are here just expanding, you know what I mean? And I know the economy is really bad, but trying to get people in, what do we do to kind of bring them in? I mean, the website's there, but...
All the above.
All the above, exactly. Yeah. Cold call, you know, mostly the cold calls are ones that, one, are referred to me, like the American Tire distributor. You know, Mike Bergeron said, hey, you might want to check these guys out. You know, they're looking in the area. And when I say southern New Hampshire, I don't just mean Manchester and Londonderry. I mean southern New Hampshire from Concord on down. That's where they're looking. From Concord on down, from Keene to Portsmouth. That's where they're looking. And now it's just a
amount of work to get them to come here.
And, you know, it's just a lot of calling and saying, you know, here's what we have. Here's this incentive. Here's this piece of land. This is this piece of land that has, water and sewer. Here's a piece of land that had a prior approval on it, you know, for 40,000 square feet. I know you're looking for that around that amount. At first, they were looking for something that can contain 40,000 or 50,000, but then it increased to 125.
I'll give you an example. So I don't know how to really figure out a way of doing this, and that's why I'm giving this to you, because obviously you do, being in the business. But
if you look at like Chinese food restaurant in Derry, you know, they're looking to expand, you know what I mean? I just know that from talking to people, you know, going into the restaurant. Convenience store companies like myself, you know, Teske food shops, are always looking to expand. So do we have like a site that kind of comes, you know, we just had a company move out, you know, there's a large building that's available. Do we look at those similar companies and say, hey, you know, maybe write a letter, I don't know if that's within the budget, to kind of say, hey, listen, we have a great spot, great space for you. You know, give us a call if you're interested. You know, these type of companies that are doing, you know, fairly well in these bad economic times. I mean, I guess what I'm saying is that, are we relying mostly on the word of mouth and mostly on our website, or are we kind of...
No, I mean, just so you, I can answer you as clearly and succinctly as I can, no, we reach out. I mean, we reach out and I talk to people. I call people. If I get a lead on anything, I follow up on that lead, or, you know, to call them up and say, hey, I think this will, or actually to find out what exactly that they want. You know, do you want to meet near the airport? Do you want to be near the center? Do you need, where do you want to be? And also go after those type of entities that will be successful in Londonderry. Obviously, in the airport area, if I go after a manufacturer, especially one that deals with defense-oriented type of things, be very successful in the airport area. Or if I go after somebody who was in the financial industry, then boy, that too could be very successful. So those are the things those are the type of things, you know, not all comprehensive, but those are the type of entities I go after. So any one of the people that I network with that are either a realtor or a developer or owner or whatever, where, you know, I hand my business out just like anybody else and say, you know, boy, if you're interested in doing anything, sometimes they give a call and say, you know what, I do have an idea. I do have something. So we do reach out as much as we can. And also, I pay a lot of attention to our existing businesses to let them know. That's why we hold those meetings, and I attend to these meetings there, and I go and talk about Pettingill and Londonderry as general, just so, because usually after I talk, about three or four, maybe sometimes or more, people come up to me and say, you know what, I am thinking about doing something. You know, can we sit down?
And we work with the real estate agents in town too to kind of try to tell them, hey, listen.
Anybody who does business in Londonderry, you know, I try to reach out to and make sure that Londonderry is one of the first considerations if they have somebody they're working with that wants to start open up a business here or move a business or expand a business.
Thank you very much.
Andre, do we only have one economic revitalization zone up in?
Yes.
Is there any prohibition for having it down in the Jack Bridge Road area?
That is the next area I think makes logical sense in order to create one.
And what do we have to do to try to get that there?
Well, it's just a matter of filling out the paperwork, and much like we did the original enterprise zone, fill out the paperwork, get it up there, and obviously with the agreement of the town council that this is what you want to do, establish an enterprise zone, because I look at that area and I think it can use it. I think it would benefit Londonderry and businesses in that area to do it.
It doesn't cost a town anything. It's a state tax credit.
So. Correct.
And it's not insignificant. It's up to $40,000 a year for 5 years.
Correct. $200,000 over 5 years, correct.
That's a good idea. Maybe we could stop the ball rolling.
And we can have as many enterprise zones as we want. You know, obviously, it just has to meet their parameters, but we can create it, because not only the Jacksonville Road area, but I think the area in and around where Insight Technology is, I think makes for another area that I think could benefit from it.
Can we give Andre a consensus on that tonight, Dave?
Yeah.
All right.
Sure.
So John's good for it?
Yeah, I am. I am too.
Got four right now, so why don't we go forward with that and try and see if we can get that rolling for Jacksbridge.
You do that.
All right.
I heard there's going to be a contest. Tim has proposed the contest between you and him to see who can raise the most tax revenue next year.
Is that right?
Right, you know, contest between Merrimack and Londonderry to see who can, and winner takes all.
We have a collection going with the town councils.
We're going to ask you for your money tonight to put in the collection.
Is that right?
Yeah.
I've already given mine, by the way.
Tim already sent the check.
All right, so I'll be looking for his check with his name on it.
No. The mole's out. That was there before he got there.
So that was, you know.
All right, listen, I heard he's up for it.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's always good when you start out with 800,000 square feet of retail.
We told him he can't have that.
Yeah, it's always good. Yeah.
Yeah, well, he said something about you inheriting a power plant, so, you know, we won't go there.
he did get you on that one.
Yeah, I don't know, he said something about a contest. I like it.
I love the challenge.
A little spirit, yeah. That's
I would
bad.
Love the challenge with my counterpart over in Merrimack.
Your counterpart, yeah. All right. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Nice detailed report. Keep up the good work. Let's see if we can't get that Jack Spruce thing going. Okay, new business. We already heard the first resolution. The second one?
Yeah.
Somebody want to read it?
Sure.
Get to it.
Thanks.
I got it.
Okay.
Sure. resolution number 2012-03. Resolution relative to election campaign video policies. The first reading today, March 5th, 2012. Whereas the Londonderry Town Council wishes to establish a policy to provide all political candidates with equal opportunity in the airing of campaign videos, and whereas the Londonderry Town Council fully supports the principle of protecting and safeguarding the right and opportunity of all candidates to have equal access to the cable studio and facilities, as well as equal public access channel time. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Londonderry Town Council that the election campaign videos policy, copy of which is attached, is hereby amended. Move resolution 2012-3 to second hearing date, public hearing on March 26, 2012.
Second.
Now, Dave, I've seen an amendment already on it. You're going to... Either way, tonight is my last day as town council chairman, so that will have to be changed to whoever the next chairman would be.
Yes, that's correct.
Okay.
Also, staffs are looking at this and is developing additional ideas for your discussions on the 26th to make it even more flexible.
Excellent. Mm-hmm. Perfect. Okay, so we need any discussion from the council? Just a consensus to move it to the public hearing? All right. All those in favor of resolution 2012-03, signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed? Chair votes affirmative. Motion passes 4-0. All right, approval of minutes.
Looks like we got two sets for minutes tonight. We got a council meeting of January 12th and February 27th. So a motion for approval with the amendment that I sent to Margot today as a representative in our packet.
Okay, motion. I can do a second.
Second.
Okay, motion and a second. That was a tie. So I'll flip that one and give it to Tom Farida. Chair prerogative.
There you go.
Anyway, all those in favor of John's motion with amendment, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Chair votes affirmative. Motion passes 4-0. Other business. Liaison reports. We'll start with Mr. Farrell.
Elderly Affairs continues to have their monthly programs. It's the last Wednesday of the month so that they can look at the significant issues that are happening to the elderly in our community. So you need to check the calendar for those and anybody you know. Such things as, you know, how to write a will, what are you covered for under health care, et cetera, et cetera. Old Home Day Committee has started their meetings. I unfortunately have been out of town for them, but my daughter has been attending since she's participating this year. So that's all getting started for August. And that airport, nope, all set. That's it for me.
Okay, Tom?
No report.
Yeah, vacation week.
Well, I attended a master plan steering committee. I think it was two of them. Well, not since the last meeting last week, but I forgot to update council. So,
okay.
Master plan steering committee and the subcommittee get double duty on that one. And I think Andre basically already updated the council as far as the contract between TPUDC. I keep getting that wrong. The consultant that we hired, and that contract being signed, as well as the subcommittee working on the telephone survey. I've learned more about telephone surveys than I wish I ever had to learn, but unfortunately...
I've been through that like three or four times.
Yeah,
it's bear and a half.
Unbelievable, yeah. So we cut it down to... I guess we want to have a 15-minute survey, and 1 minute it was 25 minutes, the next minute it was eight minutes, and then they added the must-haves. It's been all over the place. But
Did you make sure to call at the dinner hour?
Yeah, UNH is trying to explain to us why it's important to have these questions on it. But this is just one phase of I'm sure, a lot more surveys being taken. And it's coming along. We're moving. It's a slow pace, and it's very involved. But I think we have the right members on it. People are very involved, and they're more than willing to give their opinions about things. So.
Yeah, UNH Survey Center did a great job on us for the small area master plan. Yeah. Really comprehensive. They really knew what they were doing.
Right.
Cool. Sounds like it's in good hand.
Yeah.
Dave?
Nothing to report this time except for town meeting is Tuesday.
Well, I think Reed will probably give us that before we adjourn, right?
I'm still working with council to look at the definition of the charter regarding the organizational meeting. That first section may be for the transition, which happened 15 years ago. So we may not need a meeting next week. If we do, then again, I'll just, you can refresh your availabilities and we'll have a 5-minute meeting comply with the charter. But that may be a transition provision we don't have to worry about, so we can move right to the 26th.
Okay. Board committee reappointments and appointments. We have appointment of Bonnie Ritvo to the Elders Affairs Committee as an alternate.
Motion to appoint Bonnie Ritvo to the Elders Affairs Committee as an alternate with a term to expire in December 14th, 2004. Why is it December 14th?
Should be the 31st.
Might have been a typo.
It's amended to
December 12-14.
12-13. 12-31. 2014.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed? Chair votes affirmative. Thank you for Bonnie for stepping up to the Elder Affairs Committee.
You're motion now to adjourn.
We need to. I figure the last meeting for me as a chair. Did you want to plug for people to come to Election Day next week?
Well, I was thinking if I didn't say a word, maybe they'll all come.
No, that's not how it works. You know the deal.
Reed Clark, 79 Stonehenge Road. The 13th is voting day. Voting day has three purposes. Townspeople should show interest in their town and come and vote. The favorite of the people running should be there to show themselves up as people. So people should be there to show themselves, and people should come to vote for them. Lately, it's been very, very sparse. This year, I'm predicting it's going to be the biggest since I've been voting, and I've been voting for 60-odd years. And I think the biggest one is going to be this year. Prove me right and come and vote. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Reed. I had one more thing I wanted to do. Public comment was for Warren Jennings. Just wanted to thank him for his service for being on the Manchester Airport Authority, and thank him for his service. And I know he doesn't wish to be reappointed, which is why we had the interviews tonight. So just wanted to say thank you from the council. And that's all.
I'll renew my motion to adjourn.
Motion?
Second.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed? Chair votes affirmative. 4-0. Motion passes. We now adjourn.